Good afternoon. We're going to get started. I just want to check with Denzel that the online audience is hearing us. You can give this a thumbs up, Denzel.
Yes, yes, that's all good. All good.
Okay. So good afternoon and a very warm welcome to today's symposium that's being held in celebration of Professor Solly Benatar's 80th birthday. I'm Graham Mankis. I'm the second chair and deputy head of the Department of Medicine at UCT and Curtis Care Hospital. And I really want to welcome you on behalf of the whole Department of Medicine, but particularly our head of department, Professor Ntobeko Ntuzi. Very sadly, Ntobeko can't be here this afternoon because he has COVID himself, but he will be joining and will be speaking online. Because of the necessities of these times, we have a small group in attendance at the Neuroscience Institute, but a very large audience joining us via MS Teams. In particular, I'd like to welcome Professor Benatar himself, who's for the online audience. Solly is sitting in the front row. And Solly's family, Evie, David, and Michael, who's attending virtually, and Brian, as well as Solly's sister, Jackie Smith. And a special welcome to many of Solly's colleagues who've worked with him for many decades go back a long time in his career, who are joining us either in person or online today. I will also acknowledge that we will be joined by Dr. Karen Begg, who is the Acting Dean of the Faculty of Health Sciences. So this is a very special day for our department, providing us with the opportunity to reflect on and acknowledge the many decades of contributions that Solly has made to our department in very, very many ways, as a clinician, as a scholar, as a teacher, a mentor, a leader, a role model, a bioethicist, an advisor, a supporter, a friend, and a mensch. Professor Benatar was the head of the Department of Medicine at UCT and at Curtis Care, where he was the chief physician from 1980 to 1999, and founding director of the UCT Center for Bioethics from 1992 to 2012. After his official retirement in 2007, and in his role as an emeritus professor in the department, Solly has maintained a sharp interest in the life of the department, but also importantly in the people of the department, frequently writing an email of encouragement or an email of congratulations, providing wise counsel and providing support to the department and its members in very many ways. Most of Solly's academic career is bound up with the department. And I really want to emphasize this is the standing of our department today within our communities, within the university, within our country and globally, owes much to Solly's contributions in these very many roles. It's our hope today that the program will capture the essence of these contributions. The program has been designed to mirror the academic journey that Professor Benatar has taken through his career, through clinical medicine, respiratory medicine, bioethics, human rights, healthcare systems and health disparities, and global health issues. The objective of today's symposium is not merely to reflect on Professor Benatar's contributions, but to more broadly provide historical as well as contemporary perspectives on each of the academic fields to which Professor Benatar has contributed in his scholarly work. Many, but not all of the speakers today have collaborated with Professor Benatar. After each of the talks, we hope to have a few minutes for questions and reflections from the floor. So on to this afternoon's program. Our first speaker is Professor Ntobeko Ntuzi. Ntobeko is a cardiologist. He's the head of Department of Medicine and chair of medicine at the University of Cape Town and at Curtis Care Hospital. He serves as the clinical lead for cardiac MRI at UCT, and he's also a principal investigator based at the Cape Heart Institute and at the Cape University's Body Imaging Center, CUBIC. I know that Ntobeko would have loved to have been here today in person for this for the event, to lead the proceedings and to share in the celebrations, but unfortunately COVID has prevented that. We're very grateful that nonetheless Ntobeko is able to share his reflections in his talk this afternoon. Because of load shedding, so there's really been two challenges. There's been the challenge of COVID and then the spectre of load shedding. And Ntobeko decided to record his talk beforehand to ensure that he was able to deliver the talk. But I know Ntobeko is joining online. So Ntobeko will address the topic of Professor Benatar's role in the Department of Medicine and the department's growth to the present. So over to Ntobeko.
Thank you, Graham, for your words of welcome and for that warm and generous introduction. Laughter is timeless, imagination has no age, and dreams are forever. These were the words of Walt Disney talking about the movie industry. Today, we celebrate the timeless imagination, the laughter, and the dreams of men and women like Solly Benatar, on whose foundation our very existence and success lies. A very belated birthday wish to you, Solly. In the Xhosa tradition, which I'm most familiar with, and I'm certain in the Jewish tradition, and in most societies world over, we value, cherish, respect, and revere our elders for their experience, their wisdom, their perspective on events and dramas of our day. And what better way to show our gratitude and affection than to actually tell our elders what we think of them and to acknowledge how they have shaped our lives. And so we gather today, friends, to celebrate the enormous contributions of Emeritus Professor Solly Benatar to our lives and to the work of our department over a sustained period. Emeritus Professor Solomon Benatar, Mrs. Evelyn Benatar, their three sons, Professor David Benatar, Dr. Michael Benatar, and Mr. Brian Benatar, and their families, members of the extended Benatar family, members of the deanery, Dr. Karen Beck, Deputy Dean for Undergraduate Studies and current Acting Dean, Dr. Bhavna Patel, Chief Executive Officer, and the entire management at Krodeskia Hospital, past and present staff and students of the Department of Medicine, colleagues in the Faculty of Health Sciences and the University of Cape Town at large, our alumni, donors, and funders, friends of the Department of Medicine and University of Cape Town, I welcome you all to this celebratory symposium to commemorate 80 years of a life very well lived by our beloved colleague and friend, Solly Benatar. My only sadness is that I am unable to join you today and therefore unable to host this auspicious event in person. To paraphrase from my good friend, Professor Valerie Mizrahi, it's incredible that a virus with so few genes can cause so much havoc. Solly, I've made an effort for you and gotten out of my pajamas and even put on a tie for today's occasion. Solomon Robert Benatar was born on 6 February 1942 in Selukwe, southern Rhodesia, now called Chirugwe in Zimbabwe. He matriculated from Prince Edward School in Salisbury, now Harare, and registered for his MBCHB at the University of Cape Town, graduating in 1965. He married Evelyn Mary Goldbeck, and they had three children, David, Michael, and Brian. Following a brief stint in private practice, in general practice in Port Elizabeth, he returned to Cape Town to train in anesthetics, obtaining his fellowship of the College of Anesthesiologists in 1971. Then he saw the light and decided to train in medicine, also at Fredeskier Hospital, passing his MFCP UK exams in 1972. Following his training as a physician in Cape Town, he took up a research fellowship to study pulmonary physiology through the British MRC at Northwick Park Hospital in London. This was followed by a stint as a research fellow and honorary pulmonary registrar at the Royal Brompton Hospital and the Cardiothoracic Institute, now linked to Imperial College in London. He returned to Cape Town to take up a post as a consultant in the Division of Pulmonology, and this was followed by a period of prolific productivity with many seminal publications that influenced practice and have been highly cited. This included in 1977, the year of my birth, his publication of the article on sarcoidosis in South Africa, now a classic reference. In 1980, he was promoted ad hominem associate professor at the University of Cape Town. Shortly after this, he was appointed to succeed Stuart Saunders as professor of medicine and the fifth chair and head of the Department of Medicine at the University of Cape Town and Grotesquier Hospital. Solly inherited a department that had been ravaged by an adverse political climate, a mass exodus of experienced clinicians and academics overseas, and many also moving into the private sector, and frequent healthcare budget cuts from the province. Despite these challenges, frequent political boycotts, an ongoing flight of staff into the private sector or overseas during his tenure, Solly managed to stabilize and grow the Department of Medicine. It is this period from 1980 to 1999 that I wish to focus the majority of my remarks and on the legacy that Solly built within the Department of Medicine. I wish to return to focus on his work as chair of medicine a little later. However, many will be mindful that Solly has consistently reinvented himself so that he could continue to make the biggest impact. In 1992, he established the UCT Bioethics Center and was founding director from 1992 to 2012. He served as president of the International Association of Bioethics from 2001 to 2003. Following stints as annual visiting professor in medicine and public health at the University of Toronto between the years 2000 and 2007, he was appointed a member of the faculty at the McLaughlin School for Global Health and a professor in the Dalhousie School of Public Health at the University of Toronto from 2008 to 2013. Between 2016 and 2018, he was appointed a distinguished senior scholar in global health ethics and public health policy, also at the University of Toronto. During this period, he remained a key member of our department, serving as a mentor to a generation of physicians and always keen to lend his intellect and sharp wit to discussions on difficult ethical matters as frequently arise in clinical medicine and research. While wearing the many hats of a head of medicine, from overseeing clinical platforms and clinical governance to teaching, mentoring, supervising and training, to managing and administering, Solly was able to maintain his academic outputs, publishing over 300 articles before his retirement and many more since. and his academic achievements were duly noted through fellowships of the Royal College of Physicians in 1981, elected Foreign Associate Member of the US National Academy of Sciences Institute of Medicine in 1989, Honorary Fellowship of the American College of Physicians in 1993, the founder member of the South African Academy of Science in 1994, Fellow of the University of Cape Town, also in 1994. He was elected honorary foreign member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences in 1996, and a fellowship of the Royal Society of South Africa in 1997. Elected honorary member of the Alpha Omega Alpha Honor Medical Society in California in 2002. An elected fellow of the Hastings Center in New York in 2004, an elected fellow faculty, fellow of the Faculty of Medicine at Imperial College London in 2005, an elected fellow of the Ethox Center at the University of Oxford in 2009. And along these many and prestigious fellowships, Solly was the recipient of many awards and prizes, including the Hans Snickers Memorial Award, the University of Calgary Faculty of Law and Faculty of Medicine Award, the Golden Jubilee Award from the Colleges of Medicine of South Africa, the Mayor of Cape Town's Medal, the Harry Knowles Beecher Award, and the Global Forum for Bioethics Research Award, amongst many others. Now, impressive as this academic record may be, what of Solly the man? As the fifth chair of medicine at UCT and the head of medicine at Rodeskier Hospital, Solly joined a select group of individuals to whom we owe a great deal of gratitude. And if we stand tall as a department today, it is precisely because we stand on the shoulders of these giants. Like the other giants in this line of leadership, Solly left an indelible mark on the identity and soul of this incredible department in its 103-year history. It is indeed upon timeless imagination, the laughter and the dreams of these brave leaders that the foundation of our very existence and success as a department lies. In addition, Solly has the distinct claim to being the only previous chair of medicine still alive today. So what of Solly the manager? Many of his contemporaries remember Solly as a kind, supportive, and caring head of medicine, who always had time to stop and listen. Many remember him for his bravery and moral fortitude, an unsurpassed intellect with ever-present clarity of thought and speech, evident whenever he spoke up against injustice, be it at a faculty board meeting, in the university senate, or in writing in a newspaper article. But most importantly, all of those who worked with him remember his constant and unwavering support. What of Solly as a leader? Reflecting on Solly's leadership as chair of medicine, Emeritus Professor Eric Bateman had this to say. He was a fearless leader and didn't mind confronting wrong or simply poor decisions by both university and hospital leadership. I'm sure this sometimes didn't go down well, but he is so principled that he simply could not let things pass. I admired his bravery. He was also fiercely opposed to wrong. His weapon was clear thinking, in other words, logic, and an ability to express things clearly. This is also very clear in his writings, his letters to journals, newspapers, and the like, which were all well-reasoned and reasonable, yet direct. As a department, we could always depend on his working tirelessly on our behalf and at great cost. His contributions at faculty board meetings were always highly appropriate and a welcome relief. He generally saw issues much more clearly than his peers. Yet he was supportive and thoughtful in relation to his staff. He would phone often to find out how the family was or when some event required comment, and he felt support and encouragement when necessary, end quote. What of Solly as a colleague? Solly's kindness and respect for his colleagues was not limited to his academic equals, all of whom speak exceptionally highly of him as a colleague. Apparently, he was revered by his administrative staff because of the respectful manner he engaged them. I'm grateful to Emeritus Professor Janet Segi, who shared with me an excerpt from Solly's Girls, I presume an academic predecessor to Charlie's Angels. Such was the fondness of the secretaries in the department for the men. They called themselves Solly's Girls. And on the occasion of his 80th birthday last month, they jointly penned this message. For a man with such a distinguished career, it is rare to find one so humble and with such empathy, care, and love for all those around him. Solly always professed he could never have done the job without his faithful team of girls. However busy he was, he never missed a day to come to each of us individually to find out how we were and if he could help with any problems. We remember happy occasions when we invited to share a meal at Solly and Evie's home in Newlands, Evie having prepared delicious food and on one special occasion, gifting us with her own marmalade made with lemons from Israel. We recall one of his sons remarking, "Gee, Dad, you've got 8 secretaries." Indeed, Solly, you did have 8 of us, and we all had a part to play. It was a great privilege and a pleasure to have worked with Solly for so many years and been part of our truly unique team. What of Solly the thinker? In grappling with the current dynamics within our university today, which is a small microcosm of the larger and complex society we all belong to, I have found myself going back often to some of Solly's writings from 20, 30, or 40 years ago. Writing about the social, cultural, and religious constraints to freedom of speech and freedom of scholarship and science, Solly had this to say: "The scientific worldview and the value placed on individual freedoms, concepts which have matured over the past 3 centuries, have greatly contributed to human progress. In a world characterized by widely different cultural, social, and economic trajectories of development, and by imperialistic attitudes to human progress, the application of these modern concepts have regrettably also given rise to the most devastating threats to the survival of our planet. It is these paradoxical effects of progress and the balance between them that account for a diversity of constraints to freedom of science and scholarship. As with these ideologies, the balance is tipped in an unfavorable direction when the approach to application becomes totalitarian. Human progress and global welfare are dependent on a new and deeper understanding of forces creating and sustaining intercultural conflict, and on endeavors to overcome these by promoting wisdom, humility, and foresight in the application of knowledge for the long-time benefits of our world. End quote. Ladies and gentlemen, I wish to emphasize this last sentence. Our collective endeavor to try and promote wisdom, humility, and foresight in the application of knowledge for the long-term benefits of our world. These words as true today as when Solly first penned them. When I asked Emeritus Professor Patrick Comerford how he remembered Solly's tenure as chair of medicine, he had this to say. The social and political turmoil in the late 1970s had a devastating effect on the university and Grotesquier Hospital, and the Department of Medicine was not spared. There was a major exodus of senior experienced staff. The cardiac clinic lost 3 of its 6 consultant staff in the space of months. Endocrinology and gastroenterology were similarly affected. Many of us juniors were promoted to fill gaps for which we were not really qualified. I, for example, was appointed to a consultant position after only 15 months as a senior registrar in cardiology. Of course, at that time, there was no cardiology exam and cardiology was not a registered specialty. So Solly took over a sadly weakened and very young department. Patrick Comerford goes on to say, but his enthusiasm, optimism, and support for all staff earned him our affection and in turn our support of him and his efforts. He asked for the extra mile and most of us were prepared to go that distance for him. As an example, he asked consultants in the cardiac clinic to do some general medicine ward work to strengthen the general firms. Most agreed readily. And Pat Comerford concluded by saying, when he retired, he left a department immeasurably larger and stronger than the one he took over. There are countless generations of physicians world over, and many in this department who have considered Solly to be a mentor, even without his awareness. So, what of Solly, the mentor? I wish to return to Emeritus Professor Janet Segi, who states with great pride, and I might add glee, I first worked for Solly as a registrar on the Saunders firm and also in the respiratory unit. She states, I appointed him as mentor and sought to emulate his general demeanor and professionalism. Later, he recruited me back from Vets, which is when I joined the Benatar firm as a consultant. Several years ago, she states, I offered an editorial to the SAMJ entitled On Mentorship, in which I quoted an American football coach. We do not choose to become a mentor. Rather, others choose us because our actions are being watched by others, end quote. She goes on to say that, my friendship with Solly stretches back to 1976 when, as a registrar physician, I worked with him as my consultant physician in one of Grotesquier's general wards and in the respiratory ICU. What were the qualities and attributes that led me to appoint Solly as my mentor, she asks. Early on, I perceived his warmth and humanity and his manifest caring and compassion for his patients and their family members and his willingness to share his skill, knowledge, and expertise. Later, I came to appreciate his stewardship of the Department of Medicine as its head and his generosity towards colleagues, junior and senior and undergraduate, and his secretarial staff, who named themselves Solly's Girls. A down-to-earth individual who always treated others with respect and had much time to share with junior colleagues. This is how I and many of Solly's mentors remember him. Friends and colleagues, I wish to end my reflections today on Solly's contributions as chair of medicine by borrowing from his own words on both the future of our department and the future of medicine in this country. Solly remarked in his inaugural address following his appointment as professor of medicine and chair of this department in 1981. The foresight and vision of the University of Cape Town and the Cape Provincial Administration in designing the joint agreement and the tenacity of all concerned in sustaining it through difficult periods must be acknowledged. For without this mutually beneficial arrangement between the province and the university, it is unlikely that research or clinical activities would have developed to the same extent." End quote. Today, grateful for the wonderful relationship that exists between these two custodians of spheres of our activity, I repeat Solly's words with gratitude, acknowledging our ancestors and predecessors who had the foresight to enter into this joint agreement, which has been the bedrock of our success as a department. Solly also made substantive commentary on the future of medicine and healthcare in this country in his 2014 New England Journal of Medicine paper, co-authored with another chair of this department, the late Professor Bongani Mayosi. They stated, "Much of the hope for narrowing disparities in the New South Africa was embedded in the reversal of legislated racial discrimination generally, and in aspirations for more equitable provision of healthcare specifically. But this places too much emphasis on legislation and biomedicine as the dominant routes to improved health without consideration of the social determinants of health and the complexity associated with the effective practical application of new laws and health services. The long-term challenges in South Africa are now two narrow disparities in wealth, health, and education, and to generate opportunities for many more people to survive childhood, reach their full human potential, and lead healthy, productive lives. In the medium term, improving access to sustainable and effective healthcare services is a high priority. Short-term measures should include strengthening public healthcare services, improving resource allocation policies, and the training of an appropriate balance of healthcare professionals. Nurses and community healthcare workers will probably play an increasingly important role in rural areas. Efforts to achieve sustainable improvements in health with limited resources and much reduced prospects for economic growth call for improved healthcare management and governance and widespread shifts in attitude to doing better with less. Sustaining the ambitious national shift into a new paradigm arguably requires that other countries also make major shifts in their policies and expectations to facilitate survival on a planet with increasing constraints on natural resources and many threats now to a fragile ecologic environment. Such complex, perhaps even intractable, local and global problems require transdisciplinary socio-political economic research projects that could reframe the nature of progress and perspectives on ourselves as local and global citizens." End quote. Solly, congratulations on your 80th birthday. Thank you for your immense contributions to our department over many years. And thank you for who you are and what you have been to our department. I wish you many more years of good health. L'chaim.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ntobeko. I hope you're hearing the applause for that really deep reflection on what Solly has meant to our department and his fine attributes, and really sets the scene for today's symposium. So the next aspect of the program is we're going to hear from four colleagues in short talks, their experiences of working with Solly in different capacities, and really speak to the issue of Solly, the clinician and mentor. So first up, we're going to hear from Rob Dyer. Rob is an emeritus professor and a senior scholar at UCT and former second chair of anesthesia and perioperative medicine at UCT and Khuriskia. Rob worked with Solly from early in his career and notes that Solly strongly influenced his career and development. So would you come up, Rob, to just share some reflections on your work with Solly?
Well, firstly, thank you very much to the Department of Medicine for giving me this opportunity to speak to a great mentor and friend, Professor Benatar. So I thought the best way I could do this would be to, because it's so personal, I think I would just give a few anecdotes of times that I've spent in close to Professor Benatar. And the first one was when I was a houseman in the Benatar firm in 1981. I just arrived, feeling a bit intimidated, and as usual, it was an all-night stint, and I was out on the what is really a really beautiful balcony at the end of the D1 ward. Ironically, became gynae and obstetrics subsequently, the department, but the Benatar and Saunders firms had beds and then mixed on the balcony. And I was busy taking bloods and speaking to a patient, and Professor Benatar came in 5:45 in the morning, which wasn't uncommon for him. And he greeted me. I felt a bit intimidated, but he immediately made me feel at ease. And he said, "You must realize that you're very lucky, because here you are 5:45 in the morning, looking after your patients, and you're looking out over the Stellenbosch Mountains and the sun's coming up and everybody else is stuck in bed and they don't see this." So I thought, well, now that's a unique take on the situation. But in actual fact, you know, I thought the man's got a point. And that was the first big thing he taught me, is just be thankful for the fortunate position that you're in. The second circumstance was the following year, where I was doing senior house officer job in respiratory unit, and I'd had very little training in tracheal intubation. And of course, one goes like a lamb to the slaughter down to medical outpatients, where you deal with asthmatics who are on maximal medical therapy and tiring and looking like they need tracheal intubation. And little did I know that, of course, these are some of the highest risk patients for tracheal intubation, because they've got no reserve. And it was starting to intimidate me. So I went to Professor Benatar, made an appointment with him, and went to his office, and he was so sympathetic and so encouraging and helpful. And he suggested to me that I do a stint in anesthesia. Well, it's some stint, Professor Benatar, it's been 40 years. But it in actual fact was wonderful advice. And I still managed to successfully complete the SHO job. Now, the third scenario was probably one of the greatest things I learned was Professor Benatar's leadership in a team environment. Just imagine the Falconer Theatre, which we're all, I think most of us are familiar with, which is now on the J floor. It's a tall stalls, very narrow radius, little lecture theatre. It's dramatic, it's intimate, it's a great environment for holding small medical meetings. And there we were, all the junior staff, some nurses at the back sitting, and then Professor Benatar holding court with people like Lionel Opie, Helen Brown, Louis Vogelpool, Anders Swanepoel, Stuart Saunders. And the registrar was presenting a case of cardiomegaly, and it was a difficult one. It was quite advanced disease. Was this mitral valve disease? Was this cardiomyopathy? Was it pericardial effusion? Nobody could quite make their mind up, despite Professor Benatar trying to lead the discussion in all the right directions. And sitting next to Professor Benatar was one Rodney Hewitson, who is a great cardiac surgeon and really a man that all of us enjoyed working with enormously. But he lends new meaning to the term a man of few words. He never used to say anything. And Professor Benatar turned to him as an afterthought and said, "What do you think, Rodney?" So he said, "I think it's a tumor." "You think it's a tumor? Why do you think it's a tumor?" "Because the left heart border is irregular." Now, there's a man who's sitting who wouldn't have made any necessary contribution to the discussion had it not been for Professor Benatar's ability to draw out that group of people and get to the diagnosis, because that's the only thing that mattered to him. It was not about ego. It was not about who came up with it, but there it was. And it made such an impression on me, I've just never forgotten that meeting. And the last scenario was a very difficult one. I had started reading your work on the ethics of distribution of resources in the hospital. You wrote quite a lot on this in your early days in ethics. And obviously, cardiac surgery is an area where a lot of money can be spent on a case and the outcome may not necessarily be good. And that is not necessarily a bad thing, but we had a case of a poor, unfortunate young woman who'd had four previous mitral valve procedures, including one redo valve replacement. And she was put up for a heart transplant. And she had low-grade sepsis, and we did the transplant, and I can remember stumbling out of theater after about 12 hours, and the patient did not survive the heart transplant. And based on, quite largely on your writings, I called a small symposium which included physicians, anaesthetists, nurses, and cardiologists, and Professor Comerford, Pat Comerford was there, I don't know if he still remembers, and some very valuable discussion came out of it. So, In this way, you actually influenced me a lot in my thinking at that stage. I also know that you would have been very sympathetic to Francis Ames and Philip Tobias in the matter of the Biko case, the Steve Biko case. And I know that you've written and I've read your and your son David's writings on the matter in later years. So finally, if I can just say, I think that anesthesia, your initial discipline, in my opinion, definitely influenced you in your ability to make pragmatic decisions, which is very important in your leadership and also as a contributor to your diagnostic, unbelievable, excellent diagnostic skills as a clinician. I think that pragmatism from anesthesia added to your intellect, to which has been alluded many times now, really made you the special clinician that you were or are. And finally, I'd like to thank you for your loyalty, because you've been very loyal to our department in terms of supporting our research day for years and years, and you even gave the Gaisford Harrison Memorial Lecture, and it was a really spellbinding experience to have you there. So thank you very much. Happy birthday. And Mazel Tov. Thank you.
Thanks, Rob, for sharing those meaningful memories. So our next input is going to be from Professor Gary Martins. Gary is a clinical pharmacologist and infectious disease physician, the immediate past head of the Division of Clinical Pharmacology in the Department of Medicine, and now a senior scholar at UCT. Gary's worked most of his career in the Department of Medicine, in our Department of Medicine, and has obviously worked with Sully in many capacities. And so I've asked Gary to share a few memories.
Hi, happy birthday, Sully, and hi, everybody. I'm going to start with my interview for registrar job. Sully hauled out my student photograph, and I didn't have a glorious undergraduate career. I had an attitude. I wasn't happy as a student. And my photograph showed me with shoulder length hair, scowling at the camera. Sully hauled it out and he roared with laughter. And I thought, this is not a good start to an interview. But there was something so human about the laughter that it made me realize that actually this wasn't a threatening thing. It was just genuinely funny, and it was actually quite funny for myself to see that old photograph of myself. My second anecdote is towards the end of my registrar training, Solly had suggested that I do a paper on Miru TB, which is my first big paper. And I sweated blood on this retrospective study for months and months and months, produced the first draft, which in those days was practically done in longhand. We didn't have desktop computers. And I triumphantly handed him the first draft, which was had been typed by his team of girls, I think as they were called, I subsequently heard. Solly took it and he said, unfortunately, I'm off to Canada for a couple of months on Monday. I think I handed him on Thursday or the Friday. And I'll only really be able to get back to this when I come back. My face fell because I'd spent so much time on it, but you know, I had to just accept this. The next day I got a call from his secretary and she handed the first draft back to me. It was full of red ink, because it was my first paper draft after all. But that really stuck with me, that he must have been so busy, but he saw how disappointed I was and he actually just nailed it. And that turned out to be a wonderful paper. And that's something that really stuck with me. Next anecdote is towards right at the end of the registrar training, Solly called me in for the sort of career chat. Things had gone fairly well, and what did I want to do, and what subspecialty was I interested in? So I said, well, I quite like infectious diseases. And instead of saying, oh, that's very interesting, but we don't have that here, there's an opening in GIT or something, he said, oh, okay, that's interesting. And he contacted Arden Forder, who was the head of microbiology, and set up training for me to do with a microbiologist, and then subsequently arranged a fellowship for me to go to the UK. So there was this instant vision of, here's something interesting, here's something new, rather than just saying, oh, well, we don't do that, what are you talking about? So that was also, I think, real illustration of his vision, and also his humanity to see me and to appreciate my growth and my interests. And the final anecdote is more recent. Solly sporadically contacts me and always asks after my family, and he asked me some question and he said, how's Pippa? Pippa's my wife. So I said, actually, she's very unwell. She's just been admitted for a prolonged hospitalization. And Solly and Evie contacted Pippa in hospital on a virtually daily basis for the month that she was in hospital, sending her the most inspiring music, podcasts, writings, and it made such a difference to her. It was really the highlight of her hospitalization, because she was in isolation for the whole period, was this incredible, thoughtful, compassionate, insightful thing from both Evie and Sully. So thank you very much for your compassion, for your vision, and most of all, for your humanity. Happy birthday.
Thanks, Gary, for sharing those lovely memories. And you'd be pleased to know I still have a copy of that paper. I had to photostat it in the library, but I still keep it and share it with people. So the next speaker is Professor Vanessa Birch. Vanessa is currently the Executive Director of Education and Assessment at the Colleges of Medicine of South Africa. Vanessa is a specialist physician and rheumatologist who was the head of the Department of Medicine at GF Uster Hospital, and built this department into one of that had formidable and wide-reaching impact in terms of models of clinical service delivery and teaching. Vanessa succeeded Professor Benatar as the chair of medicine to become the first woman to be appointed to an established chair in the department in its over 80-year history at that stage, before moving to her current position at the college. So over to you, Vanessa.
Thank you for that introduction, Graham, and it's a real privilege to be here this afternoon. And I'm going to speak to the man directly because it's just so nice to see you, Prof. Benatar. And I don't believe I could ever call you Solly, really, so I'm going to speak to you as Prof. Benatar. People have had a number of anecdotes this afternoon, and I'm going to add to them, and you will hear a recurring theme of words. In fact, there are some common words which I will use, which have already been used this afternoon, and perhaps they highlight that when more than one person uses the same word about someone, it has to ring true for a large part of who they are and how we see them in society. I want to go to the first word being that of discipline, and yes, those early morning ward rounds just after dawn. I was one of the people doing those ward rounds as well. I was terrified, I have to tell you. But the rising sun on the way to work, because mine were a little bit later, they weren't quite at dawn, they were a little bit after dawn, softened my anxiety about doing ward rounds with you. But I think it was that march down the corridor, and many years later, someone said, you know, you walk like someone that used to work here. And I kept completely quiet, and they said, it was a short man. I said, was it Professor Ben? They said, that was the man that used to walk just the way you walk. And I thought, maybe I did learn something. But those ward rounds taught me discipline. They taught me about discipline. And then I had the extraordinary privilege of writing a very small paper with you. But again, it was the exact same experience of this turnaround time of 24 hours on a paper to get something done and get something published. And the important issue was, there's a job to be done, let's get this job done and do it efficiently and as fast as possible. And then the discipline of making an accurate clinical diagnosis. There was no beating around the bush. What's wrong with the person and what are you going to do about it? And unless you really know what's wrong with the person, you can't do much about the problem. So learning to make an accurate diagnosis was a discipline that really I did learn from you right in the early days, even as a senior house officer before I became a registrar in your firm. Then there were the issues of the dedication. The dedication to patients was clear and it was obvious and it was apparent right from the start. But I was always struck by the way in which you spoke to the families of the patients, people who were not necessarily at the bedside. They might have been standing in the passage. They might have been not apparent as being present, but always being recognized by you and being brought into the conversation. And then when I became your senior registrar or chief registrar, as we used to call them in those days, I can remember coming up to your office to the team of ladies that have already been spoken about to do the annual registrar rotation. And there was that board with those little magnets on. And there I learned about the dedication to colleagues, because that was really what that was all about. We mixed and matched that board endlessly and for hours in order to make sure that everybody got as fair a deal as possible. And I really learned about the dedication and commitment to colleagues in those early days, long before I became a consultant in the department. And then there was determination. I always watched you not give up on anything. And one day I realized that this is about being the best that you can possibly become, no matter where you come from in life and no matter what your circumstances are. And I was just so impressed by that one day I was doing one of those famous Thursday afternoon presentations, and it was going to be my turn, and I was in the ICU, and I thought, I have to do something different. I just have to do something with a little bit of a spark. And so I carried in all those bottles of scorpions for the afternoon presentation about a patient who had a parabuthus sting. But it was the determination that I had seen earlier on in my days as a senior house officer that had given me the courage to do something slightly different and bring a little bit of amusement to the audience. And then I want to turn to your humanity. That is a term that's already been used about you this afternoon. And I remember having done the fellowship and having completed my registrar training, and he said to me, you know what you need, my girl? You need a PhD. And I looked at you and I thought, really? I still have to go and do some more things? And he said, because one day you will be regretting it when others have one, and you don't have one yourself because you have the ability to have one too. And I took that really seriously, not as an indication of academic prowess, of the need to achieve academically, but of a recognition of the humanity of the person that you were speaking to and my own personal needs that would subsequently be reflected in academic needs. So thank you for that, and I thank you for that major inspiration and encouragement to go ahead and secure or at least pursue a PhD and subsequently secure one. And finally, Professor Benatar, I'd like to thank you that once when I was a patient, you came to sit at my bedside. That probably means the most to me of everything in all of 40 years, that you've had an extremely successful career. You've done extraordinary things, and people have spoken about your academic ability. They've spoken about your leadership. They've spoken about your mentorship. But I can attest to actually speaking of you as a physician, not only as a colleague at that stage, but as the physician in charge. And I want to say thank you very much for what you meant to me during that time and for all the many years that we worked together. It's been an extraordinary privilege to have worked with you. I learned an enormous amount from you, and it's been a huge privilege to be here today to actually, number one, see you, see your wife, which is really nice to see, and catch up with colleagues whom I haven't seen for a number of years, and to say thank you very much in person for what you've done, and happy birthday for your birthday last month. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much, Vanessa, for those really vivid and beautiful memories that really bring together to life Solly the clinician and the person and the humanity. So thanks, Vanessa. So next up is Professor Mpiko Ntshege. Mpiko is the Helen and Morris Meyerberg Professor and Chair in the Division of Cardiology and the Head of Clinical Cardiology at Groote. Mpiko crossed paths with Professor Benatar early in his career. And he's hopefully going to speak to that today and also speak to some of the memories regarding Solly.
Good afternoon, everybody. And like everyone else, it's an extreme privilege to be here to say happy birthday and thank you. Mine is really about a very brief but incredibly meaning encounter many, many years ago. So it does require that I contextualize it. I suspect that at least some of you in the audience will recall that strange combination of excitement, uncertainty, and anxiety that came with your final year of medical school. On the one hand, there was a prospect of finally becoming a doctor and going out after what seemed like an eternity. And on the other hand, there was that anxiety-provoking reality that despite almost becoming a doctor, we actually knew and could do very little and wouldn't want to be left alone looking after anybody, actually. Now take this usual scenario and multiply that anxiety and uncertainty by a factor of any number you could think of. 10 is what I wrote down. You see, the year was 93 and I was going into my final year at medical school in New York City. South Africa was about to be free. And there was a clarion call for us to go back and contribute and to be part of the imminent change. And it was loud and clear. The excitement amongst the Black South African community in the US at the time was actually palpable and incredible. And from family and friends, the pull to come back home after a long 10 years was huge. However, my personal reality was not so straightforward. The head and the heart weren't quite aligned. Having grown up in Zambia and Lesotho and gone to the US at the age of 15, I'd actually never lived in South Africa and I had no clue what I was coming back to. Having been in the belly of the beast for as long as I had, a part of me believed in the American way and was persuaded by many around me that any medical teaching or training outside of the US was going to be a waste of my Ivy League education. While I had heard about WITS, because my dad had happened to go there, I'd never even heard about Groote Hospital, let alone UCT. I'd only ever encountered TB in the odd patient because it happened to be New York City, and diseases like rheumatic heart disease and rheumatic fever were, you know, something I only encountered in the textbooks. I was barely competent at taking blood because that is the nature of the American system. And I had been told I was gonna have to come back and do C-sections and appendectomies. It was really very scary, and of course there was no internet and Google for me to look up what was actually the truth. So I was in this very scary place with a big decision I felt. My career or a cause, my family, or what I was told was a bright future. Enter Professor Benatar. Now, out of the blue, it was August, September of 93, I think, Professor Gerald Thompson, who we were actually talking about when I came in, called me. He was the head of internal medicine at Columbia, and called me and said there would be a visiting South African physician, head of medicine at Groote Schuur, and that perhaps I should meet him and discuss my wish to go back and some of everybody's concerns. So our meeting couldn't have lasted more than an hour, but suffice it to say, I left there with a completely transformed perspective. Most of the doubt that I had having completely dissipated, and much of the excitement that I had being very much amplified. And most importantly, I knew exactly what I was going to do. In his usual calm, confident, and extremely reassuring manner, Solly had assured me that few places on earth could match the training and teaching on offer at Groote Schuur Hospital, and that there was a reason why South African and UCT-trained doctors were sought after all over the world, and that he was sure that I would be able to not only find my feet, but thrive if I came back home. And of course, he also mentioned in passing that he happened to be in a good position to be able to persuade the GSH authorities to take me on as an intern. The rest, as they say, is history. I graduated in 95. I started my internship at GSH in 1st of January 95, and have had the great pleasure and privilege of having Solly available to me as a sounding board and guide over the last 20 years. Always supportive and always one of the first to send me an email of encouragement and congratulations for some of the important milestones and achievement that I've experienced on this journey. One of my favorite actors, Denzel Washington, says, "Show me a successful individual and I'll show you someone who has had a real positive influence in his or her life." Thank you, Solly, for being one of those very positive influences in my life and helping me see the light at a very crucial time. Thank you and happy birthday.
Thanks, Mpika. And I think there's a theme that emerged, you know, that Solly has been there at critical points in people's careers and made such an impact in small ways, but also in huge ways in terms of their career directions. So our next speaker is Professor Eric Bateman. Eric is a pulmonologist. He's the past head of the Division of Pulmonology at UCT in Groote Schuur. He's the founder of the UCT Lung Institute and served as its director for 16 years until 2016. His primary research interests include pharmacology of and management of asthma, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, tuberculosis, and community-based interventions to improve the care of patients with chronic diseases. Eric has worked closely with Solly in the Department of Medicine and in the field of respiratory medicine, and he will address us on the topic of pulmonology then and now.
Thank you, Graham, for that introduction. Solly, Evie, what a pleasure to be with you, and boys also. This is a long session, I realize, and you must wonder how many more tributes you're going to hear. Now, I was told mine is not essentially a tribute. It's meant to be a bit of a review of pulmonology then and now. But I don't want to give an exhaustive and perhaps boring talk about one of his passions and mine, but I thought what I'd do instead is just take three short topics, in which Solly would have been involved in one way or another, and you'll see that, and make comparisons of the then and the now. Now, I guess I need to set the stage by my own personal encounters with Solly, which began in 1970, a little ahead of many of you, I suspect. When I was a final year medical student, and as a very keen member of a group, we recruited him as a promising extra tutorialist for us on a Saturday morning. And he gave us, I think, two, maybe three tutorials on pulmonology. And he'd just come back, I think, from Northwick Park, probably. But he certainly blew us away with his very clear mind, his energy, his love and his passion for reason and thinking through things clearly. I remember he had cards and all his major teaching points were on the cards. And I must say, it certainly energized me as an educational encounter for that final year. And then the next vignette was when he was, I believe, a senior registrar, may have been consultant, one of the professorial rounds. He presented a case very lucidly explaining that this had to be cryptogenic fibrosing alveolitis. He also wanted to draw our attention to certain features that indicated there might be liver pathology as well. And he interrupted the round and said he had to quickly phone the pathologist to get the result of a biopsy that he'd performed. And he came back with a sort of triumphant glee and said he was happy to report that his diagnosis was correct and that in addition he'd penetrated the diaphragm and had a liver biopsy and confirmed that it was chronic active hepatitis as well. Now you can imagine for me, if I'm a young houseman, this seemed to be the acme of astute clinician. But it was always the way in which he presented it in a reasoned way that really caught my fancy. And I realized there was something that I wanted to emulate. And I suspect this is why pulmonology triumphed over cardiology as my number one objective in life. And so it was that in about 1977, I joined the unit as a senior house officer. I mean, as a trainee registrar. And these were the three consultants. There were others. Peter Porthitter was there, and there were others, but Alex Ferguson was in charge, and Solly and Bob were there. You'll notice that only Bob was dressed as we should have been dressed in those times, and just to bring back happy memories, I'm dressed the same today. Alex and Solly looked much younger then, as did we all. But they were wonderful tutors, very astute clinicians. And pulmonology was a fledgling discipline. It was still finding its feet amongst the panoply of internal medicine subspecialties. And so we were very much the poor cousins and operated in within the department, the cardiology department, which was, of course, world famous at that time. But it was a wonderful time, and Solly took his mentoring very seriously. That's come out repeatedly. We had the privilege of having one-on-one or two-on-one sessions with Solly, going through landmark papers in pulmonology and pulmonary physiology in particular, which was his particular particular forte. And I found them quite intimidating, but very, very instructive. But perhaps more important was the sort of advice he provided liberally. Like one I shall not forget was that he said if we ever wanted to write papers, as we all aspired to do, we would need to be at work at 7 o'clock in the morning and write for an hour each day before we went on our rounds. Now, he and I shared an office. There was a divide, but that put me in a very awkward position of being under his scrutiny so that he could see whether I was listening to his advice. Now, further, in those days, we used paper and pencil, and his pencil squeaked. So I could tell how productive he was being while I sucked on my pencil just next door. But nonetheless, we did manage to write some papers. And one of the first papers was on asthma, and I'll refer to it in just a moment. But this being the height of the apartheid era, like all South African society, universities had been established along and divided along ethnic and language lines. And up to that stage in my training, I had had little inkling or experience of how mainstream politics harmed science, or rather, more accurately, the climate conducive to scientific progress. And there became several examples of that over the time that I was a senior registrar, and I think they were very informative. The one example was the polarization of views about a very simple matter of the classification of respiratory or airways diseases, asthma, and COPD. And although it was 30 years since the Second World War, respiratory medicine in the old world was pretty polarized. There was the sort of English-speaking part of it that had its own emphases, and then there tended to be a European one, particularly centering on Switzerland, Netherlands, and Germany, that had a different path. Now, the influential leadership at the Lung Unit at Stellenbosch University subscribed strongly to what was called the Dutch hypothesis, which said that there was a common genetic disposition for asthma and COPD, and that essentially bronchitis and asthma were different patterns of the same condition or the same disease. And you can see there it was first proposed in 1961. Now, I couldn't understand why this polarization of views, the British view being that these were two separate conditions, the one in almost in totally environmentally induced, and the other very clearly with genetic basis, why there should be differences. However, the influential leadership at Stellenbosch, particularly Artie de Kock, was so convinced of this that he managed to persuade the MRC to form a diffuse obstructive pulmonary syndrome unit, the DOPS unit. Now, I thought DOPS was a very good name for the winelands, given that that was also part of the fabric of wine farming. But such was the difference between us and them. Now, I thought Solly might be interested to have a little update of how theories have developed since then. This was a review we wrote some years ago, in which at the top you see the gene, the genetic basis, much better worked out. And indeed, Solly and my colleagues were correct. There are different genetic predispositions, but there are also common genes affecting inflammation and repair that are seen in both conditions. So maybe everyone was right. But what is clear was that there are very many more influences upon the lungs, all the way from fetal development through to senescence, that account for the different patterns that we see with the chronic airways diseases. And indeed, if you look at the bottom of the graph, you'll see that it's quite reasonable to hypothesize that in some patients, features of both may be present, and that is a matter for another discussion. But I think that the real issues that was exposed with that sort of difference really were very much more apparent when we started differing over issues with the more overt political implication. For example, racial differences in lung function prediction equations. There was some work done within our units. Steve Lowe did one of his projects on that, Johnny Golden another, and that became a contentious issue. Also the issue of compensation for occupational lung diseases, particularly asthma and bisonosis. And here I must pay tribute to the late Neil White, who was really a very brave man in taking on this very controversial area against a lot of political opposition, and particularly from across the Lisbic. But he stuck to his guns, and of course history has proved him correct. But of course Solly was a wonderful man to have in your corner. He stood up for us whenever there was a matter of dispute. But how are things now? Well, fortunately, relationships between different universities and certainly pulmonary departments is a lot better. In fact, it's been put on a much better footing. And I attribute it in part to the globalization of knowledge, to the fact that the European societies tended to unify and to talk to the American schools. And so our thinking became much more global and was not dominated by powerful individuals. And I think in the era of evidence-based analysis of evidence and of evidence-based guidelines, it's not possible to see that polarization that was a feature in those early years. Now, the second point I want to compare the now and the then is on the matter of the price tag associated with progress. And I'm going to talk about asthma, which is where I've spent a lot of my research life. In 1970, children with asthma were expected to live miserable lives, excluded from sport, and advised to seek other outlets. Many died in early age, and those that survived lived with being the being the most common chronic disease of childhood, people have to live with it for the remainder of their lives. Now, thanks largely to the improvements in pharmacotherapy, this has changed. And nowadays, all asthma deaths are viewed as preventable, and persons with asthma are encouraged to expect to live a normal life. And the change really began in the early 70s, just as Solly and later me joined the clinic. And at that time, we had inhaled corticosteroids. They were being introduced systematically throughout the world. It was a while before they came to South Africa, but they transformed the management of asthma. And a little later, the addition of a long-acting beta agonist was a second step forward, particularly when these were put together and used as maintenance therapy. They dramatically reduced the risk of exacerbations and improved the lives of asthma patients. So then there's the second treatment, and that's the short-acting beta agonist, or the familiar SABA pump, the blue inhaler, as people call it, which provides quick relief for symptoms and is used for breakthrough. Now, what of those who don't respond to that? There was the option to use systemic corticosteroids, and I needn't emphasize the devastating effects of maintenance corticosteroids. So there was really, for all those 20 years, only these treatments available. Theophylline and others were far less effective. But since about the year 2000, a number of other treatments have been added, but these are principally for the 15% or so of patients who don't respond to the standard treatment I outlined. And more recently, we have 5 monoclonal antibodies that have really transformed asthma management for severe asthma. But unfortunately, many of these additional treatments come at a great price. The price of progress is too high. There are only a handful of patients in South Africa currently who are on any of these treatments, and the pace, even though they've been registered, pace of use is very low. So sadly, there is a price, and we're left with what is considered to be standard treatment. However, we have to recognize that standard treatment for the great majority of patients has been a great success story. That in many countries of the world, death rates are lower than 1 in a million per population per year. Very low death rates from asthma. But sadly, South Africa, the death rate remains very high and has come down very little over the 40 years since Solly first performed a study, I think it was Jill Ainsley, on asthma deaths in Cape Town. And we performed one of my first studies performed at Solly's request, was of reasons why patients repeatedly come to the Grootskeer asthma room. And the reasons that were responsible then are still relevant today. The major reasons are that patients prefer rapid reliever, they prefer the blue reliever, and they underuse inhaled corticosteroids. And inhaled corticosteroids are very freely available in South Africa. We published this paper just a couple of months ago on a survey of 24 countries, and you'll see highlighted above was that South Africa was prescribing more short-acting beta agonists than any other country. The majority received more than 3 a year, which is considered more than is necessary, and a great proportion, more than 10 inhalers in a year. And we can go back to the 80s, to those early years where epidemics of deaths were attributed to overuse and over-reliance on SABA. And so we're doing the same things in South Africa today, and we're not learning from what was learnt a long time ago. So what can be done about this? Well, over the past 15 years, there has been a change. And that is to realize that if instead of giving a short-acting beta agonist, one combines it with an inhaled corticosteroid, or a long-acting beta agonist, even better, with an inhaled corticosteroid, that is a much more effective way of treating symptoms and at the same time ensures that the inflammation does not progress to a full exacerbation, with about a 50% reduction in the risk of exacerbations. And the evidence accumulated, and this became a favored method, the anti-inflammatory reliever concept, that one gives the maintenance treatment as before, but instead gives a reliever containing an inhaled corticosteroid. Now, some of us about 15 years ago became very convinced we should be offering this to patients with mild asthma purely on an as-needed basis, simply for when they have symptoms, without the presence of daily maintenance treatment. And we feel that given the majority of patients have mild asthma, this is a real option. It took us a long time to get backing for the studies, but they were published in 2018 and 2019. And these four studies formed the basis of what now is accepted as the preferred treatment in mild asthma, simply as needed anti-inflammatory reliever. And this has found its way into international guidelines as well in the guidelines of about 40 countries. So this is an option, and I think it for lower middle income countries, if we can persuade this to become standard of treatment and we revise the WHO essential drug recommendations, it should be possible to produce combination treatments like this as a far more realistic option for low middle income countries at a price tag that can be afforded. Well, we are engaging with the WHO and other bodies to have this adopted. Now I'm going to, my last section is somewhat briefer, and I'm just going to be referring to the developments in pulmonology in the last 10 years. But I'm not qualified to do so because this is the 10th year in which I am post being the head of the Division of Pulmonology at Karolinska Hospital. But it's been a source of great pleasure and pride for me to see the team, very ably led by Kirtan Dida, expand the scope of practice of pulmonology and its repertoire. Special needs clinics, like the pulmonary hypertension clinic, smoking cessation clinic, sleep medicine, has been expanded or introduced. And there are a number of new techniques, such as EBUS, interventional bronchology, bronchial thermoplasty, and even lung transplantation. These are all developments within the last 10 years and bring the pulmonology division here up in line with what is being practiced globally. And that's not even to mention the impressive interventions together with our anaesthetic colleagues that have been introduced during the period of the COVID epidemic. But I think Kirtan would be the same, the first to admit that all is not well in pulmonology here, and even worse in many of the universities in our region because of another wave of budget cuts. We've heard about some in the 70s and 80s. There was another severe budget cut following 1990 as the health service structuring, the health service would change. And we're in the middle of yet another one, but for slightly varying reasons. And I can't help but see the similarities with the time when we formed the Lung Institute, when we realized that we needed to expand the platform for teaching and research from a hospital-based tertiary service to one that involved community work. And as I preferred to put it at that time, that used the skills that we'd been taught and developed as clinicians in very tertiary medicine and in the laboratory to apply them to the areas of need of medicine on a broader scale, initially primarily in the field of respiratory medicine, but those of you who know the repertoire of activities taking place in the Lung Institute and within the division will know that it extends to many other things like tuberculosis diagnostics, the therapeutics of tuberculosis, and not just the more mainstream pulmonological topics. And of course, also the very successful knowledge translation unit, which came directly from our interest to make a difference in primary health care, initially in the management of lung conditions and of course later expanded as the need and as the department took it on board as a viable method. So we have much to be grateful for, but the challenges remain. And the need is to remain, what I like to say, light on one's feet when one's threatened by shrinking resources in the health setting. I think we're fortunate that we're now in a phase through global collaboration that we're freed from the effects of local politics. But a challenge for us always in this region is going to be the price tag attached to progress. So in ending, I'd like to just pay tribute to Solly, who I've said to him many times, has been my mentor. He was the model on whom I sought to model my academic career and from whom I've benefited so enormously. Solly, thank you very much. And Evie, thank you for your friendship and support.
Thanks so much, Eric, for that, for those reflections, really capturing, you know, 30 or 40 years of progress in the field and really setting the scene of what pulmonology is today. So we've got time for one or two questions. If there are any questions from the floor, I have one question. And that's, Eric, just if you could reflect on the impact that the Knowledge Translation Unit has had on the management of asthma in primary care. Over the last, you know, two decades.
Well, improving management of asthma was the reason that Lara Farrell first came to me to say, can we do anything? She'd been working in primary health care. She saw how badly asthma was treated and she said, can't we improve it? And that really was the spark that led us into systematizing management at primary care level, which was then rolled out to other diseases as well. So it's been very much on our hearts. Unfortunately, the management of asthma involves a functioning health system, but it also requires medications. And so a secure, good supply, a dependable supply of medications are important, and also the right medications. So getting back to what I was trying to share with you, although the health department, and we're very fortunate in South Africa to have a health department that is responsive to putting essential drugs into the clinics, and they have done so, including inhaled corticosteroids. But as I've attempted to say, I don't think we're making the impact we should for the investment that has been made, and I think it's because our approach has been wrong. And even the advent of, although we were able in one study to show improvements in asthma care and of inhaled steroid use, we haven't been able to show a change in morbidity and mortality, although it's very difficult to study at a population level.
Thanks very much, Eric. So we have a change in the order of speakers. Our next speaker is Tracy Naledi. Tracy is a public health medicine specialist who's held technical and management positions in government and NGO sectors in South Africa and Botswana over the last 20 years. Her work is focused on the translation of research into policy and practice and addressing health inequity and strengthening systems for health. From 2020, Tracy has been the Deputy Dean for Health Services at the UCT Faculty of Health Sciences, and prior to that was the Chief Director for Health Programs at the Western Cape Department of Health. Tracy is the founding chairperson of TACANA, Atlantic Fellows for Health Equity in South Africa, and the Honorary Secretary of the Council for Public Health Medicine of the Colleges of Medicine. And Tracy's gonna speak to an issue that has really has been a key theme in Solly's academic career for many decades, and that's the issue of health disparities. Speak on the topic of persisting health disparities in South Africa, a view from the 1970s to the current.
Okay. Thank you very much for this opportunity. Molweni, Dumelang. Greetings to you, Prof, on this really wonderful day. Greetings, Mam Ivy. I had the pleasure of meeting you when you hosted you in the deanery. But for me, Prof, you are that short prof that used to walk very fast in the corridors of Groteskier. I am your student and I feel very nervous because I have some of my teachers here and kind of feels like I'm having a viva. So let's see how it goes. I'm really inspired by your work, Prof. I had the pleasure of reading a lot of your work, and I'm born in 1973. So it's been quite fascinating for me to view what has happened in my lifetime. And I'm also saddened to see, in as much as a lot has changed, but a lot hasn't. So when we look at the definition of what health disparities are, they are preventable differences. And I want to emphasize that preventable differences in the burden of disease or opportunities to achieve optimal health. A note of caution, race does not exist. But we do know that there has been racial classification in our country and other places, and that it is a socio-political construct. It's not a real thing. And this thing is really to legitimize dehumanization of people and justifying offering them less services and opportunities. So I am putting this caution out there because for many of us, this is not just a word, it means something. Many people have suffered injustice, pain, some have died, and many continue to do so. So when we do use these words and talk about these things, it's important to be empathetic and to be sensitive. However, I cannot deliver this talk without talking about race, because apartheid was a significant determinant of health disparities in South Africa. Therefore, we must talk about race with all its difficulties. Apartheid in health and in healthcare is still firmly in place and will remain a decisive force in South African health and healthcare for many years, even generations to come. While we are convinced that the elimination of apartheid is necessary to reduce the wide range of disparities and inequalities between different groups in this country, it would be naive to imagine that this will be sufficient. You've said this multiple times in different ways in your writings. So pre-94, we had fragmented health services by design. Curative services were the provincial responsibility. Prevention was the responsibility of local government. Services were fragmented by race. The Bantustans back then, where most African Black people lived, were systematically underfunded. The private sector dominated. In 1980, 40% of doctors were in the private sector, and that increased, in fact, to over 60% in 1990. People that were classified by race differently suffered disease in a very different way, and you talk about this in your writings when you analyze the burden of disease in Groteskier in the 70s. People classified as white suffered more non-communicable diseases, whereas people classified as Black and colored suffered from more poverty-related diseases and mental health. In urban areas, young women suffered from teenage pregnancies, unsafe abortions. Come 94, ANC comes into power and has the health plan, foregrounds primary health care and addressing social determinants. Post 94, establish an integrated national health system, move from the 14 fragmented, racialized health departments. National Health Act centered district health system and community participation structures that I'm saddened that have been captured by politics. We had free primary healthcare services, and we have a lot to be proud of. More than 80% of pregnant women in South Africa receive an antenatal visit. We've had increased funding, increased visits in primary healthcare, community health workers, school health services. There's lots to be proud of. We've had wonderful programs on immunization. South Africa was declared polio-free in September 2019. We have the biggest ARV program, even though there was AIDS denialist in the second term of government. We have the perinatal HIV transmission rate that is now less than 1%. We've had rights-based health services, sexual reproductive health, mental health, policies that address the key, focusing on prevention and addressing some of the key drivers of disease and injuries, tobacco, firearms, and providing social services, basic water, electricity, et cetera. And of course, as you are aware, now on the table is the National Health Insurance that is pooling public and private funding for unitary health system. So what has been the state of the population and the burden of disease? So if we look from, this is from the 1960s, what we can tell is that South Africans are living longer. And in fact, the demographers tell us that the population of those who are 50 years and over expected to double by the time by 2039 and 2040. Though we do still have a significant number of children and young people in South Africa, 38 million in 2021. We've had reduced infant and child mortality rates that we can be proud of. And also part of the challenge with youth health is that because young children have survived, we now have this bulge of adolescents. We've had improvements in the burden of disease in all provinces. You'll see that pinkish, those pinkish colors, that is HIV. And you'll see that in the middle of 2000, there was an increase of HIV that in the middle of 2000 started reducing. And you can see also that different provinces experience the burden of disease in different ways. You can see that the rural provinces, KwaZulu-Natal, Free State, Eastern Cape, Mpumalanga, have much more burden of disease than some of the more urban provinces, Western Cape and Gauteng in particular. Burden of disease is still racially profiled. If you're white and classified white and Indian, less 10% or less of premature mortality due to HIV could be attributable to that group. Those classified as colored, 20%. Those classified as African black, 40%. So you can see the significance of race in the burden of disease. There are certain things we just have not been able to get right. One of them is violence, gender-based violence. South Africa is the number one rape capital in the world. And it's not a surprise. We've got a history of violence, of war, toxic masculinity. There are many things we haven't done. We have not invested in mental health. We all remember the tragedy of life Esidimeni. Palliative care. As I said, more and more South Africans are getting older, yet we have a very thin service in terms of looking after the elderly. Rehabilitation, disease prevention, early detection and treatment. I'm saddened to say that you have highlighted this problem from back in the 70s when I've been reading your work. You've highlighted the importance of community-based services and how if we could strengthen those, it would actually have an impact on how places like Groteskier are able to provide a good quality service. So very little has changed. We've done well. We've increased life expectancy, but COVID really did a number on us. In 2021, there was a 34% increase in deaths, which meant that life expectancy reduced by 3.5 years. And if you look how long it took us to get there, it took us 15 years from the AIDS epidemic to get there. And this is where we are now. And to me, that tells us how fragile our progress has been. And I think largely because of a lot of things that you have been highlighting that we haven't really systematically addressed social and structural determinants of health. So a response to these health challenges. There's a lot that has been done post-94. We have had an increasing number of social grants. This is 2018, where a third of persons have received grants and 44% of households received grants. This is probably much more after COVID, when many people actually lost their jobs and have to receive the special grant from government. We have had an increasing number of children that were allowed to attend school without paying fees. We have had an increasing number of kids that have had school nutrition, that have been fed at school. And social services, the blue, at the bottom there is electricity. So a lot has been done in terms of addressing social determinants of health. We've increased access to education. The orange bars there you can see is matric, and the blue on top is anything post-matric. In 2002, 30% of people had matric or more. 2012 was just under 50%. But we have an issue of poor quality of education and retention. Most children drop out at grade 10. 50% do not complete matric. Pregnancy is a leading cause of school dropout in 1 in 4 learners, and the second cause being lack of financial resources. So what then you have is that post-94, South African youth are civically engaged and increasingly well-educated, but they face poor prospects and security risks, poor job prospects and security risks. And we know that at the moment, half of young people are actually unemployed. Public-private health, between 2002 and 2018, 2002, 15.9% of the population had medical aid. In 2018, that was 16.4%. So very little change in the last 20 years in terms of coverage of mental medical aid coverage. We have been able to at least change the distribution. The orange bars is the proportion which we had been spending of health rand in the private sector, and the blue is in the public sector. Even though there has been an improvement, where we are at the moment is about 50-50. So we spend 50% of money on on less than 17% of the population, and the same amount of money on the rest. The people that are covered by medical aid are largely white, 72.9% of them, and an Indian. 72% of white people are covered by medical aid, and about half of Indian and Asian people are covered by medical aid, compared that to less than 10% of African black and 17% of colored. And similarly, the rural urban divide is also prevalent. The orange bars is access to private doctors, and you can see that the more urban provinces have access to private medical care compared to more rural ones. So what has happened is that those that are the richest, if you look at the fifth quintile, the richest people have a 6% need, but they capture 35% of the share of total benefits. You compare that with the lowest, the poorest people in the first quintile, 25% need, yet they only get 13% of the benefit. Care was not administered according to need, but according to ability to pay. This resulted in doctors establishing themselves where the wealthy lived and not where ill lived. Health services were not equally available and accessible to all sectors of the population. This is still the same, Prof. Health workers. We know that most of the health workers are in the private sector. The smaller bubbles in there are the proportion that is in the public sector. 49% of nurses are in the public sector, 45% of doctors in the public sector, 37% of radiographers in the public sector. The rest are not working in the public sector. They could be private or elsewhere. We know that even the specialists, even though specialists are trained in the public sector, but many of them find their way to the private sector. What is even more disheartening is that about a third of public sector specialists do RWAPs in private which means that this is probably what is given to the public sector is even less than what we think. There is some hope. This is work that was done in WITS by Professor Lionel Green-Thompson, our dean, and others at WITS, where they found, where they followed up our medical students who had qualified between 2007 and 2011. And what they found, which is good news, is that nearly 90% of these doctors were still in South Africa. 80% of those still in South Africa, 80% of those were in the public sector. Very few were in the rural areas, less than 10%. 60% of those who were in the rural areas were Black doctors. And about half of the doctors that answered the survey were in some kind of specialist training appointment. Inequality persists. We are still the world's most unequal country. Now this, I'm gonna go slowly on, because when I saw this for the first time, I could not believe it. What it is that if you look at the bottom, the black bars, that is the increasing population of African Black people. In 1910, African Black people made up 67% of the population. In 2020, they made up just under 80%. If you look, this orangish part here, this is when apartheid ended. You can see that the biggest beneficiaries of apartheid ending had been people classified as white, followed by those that are classified as Asian or Indian. The green and the black, the green is the colored people, the black is African Black people. You can see a very small here, between 1994 and 2000, there was an increase in terms of average income for African Black people. Since 2000, that has plateaued. If you look at what, if we compare income relative to people classified as white, what you can see that in fact, since 1920, very little has changed in terms of inequality for colored and black people. Yes, there's a lot that's been spoken about around some of the changes, and people talk about the middle class. Yes, since 1980, there's been an increase in the top 10%, in the top 1%. But that still remains, regardless of the color of the people, the inequity still remains, that 1% of the population actually owns about just under 50% of the wealth. And this was in 2021. And this has increased when, during COVID, many people lost their jobs, many people lost their livelihood. The top 1% got more. This one was particularly depressing. If we look since the dawn of our democracy in 94, and you look in terms of what has happened in terms of growth in income by income group, what you can see is that the top 1% and the top 10% have increased their growth by 50%, particularly the top 1%. If you look at the bottom, the middle 40% and the bottom 50% in particular, they have reduced by 33%, by a third, since 94. The face of this poverty is largely black and female. It's largely black, female, rural women. And you can see there, the bars that are higher is all the rural provinces, Eastern Cape, KwaZulu-Natal, Limpopo. Even during COVID, women lost more jobs, and most importantly, they lost more of their jobs permanently. Inequality is not a nice to have. It actually causes harm and death. We know that people live longer in more equitable countries. We know that in equitable country, there's more disease. This is an example of South Africa being one of the most, having the highest rates of heart failure. And it's no coincidence that it has the highest inequality. So, some of the work that we still need to do, absolutely, we need to strengthen the health system, human resources for health, and I think as UCT, we have a particular responsibility around making sure we train a balanced set of health workers for all levels of care that foreground outcomes of patients. Many authors have written about the challenges of leadership, of management, of governance, both at the political level and at the community level, and that corruption is quite a challenge. We were recently in Sutherland, in the middle, in a very small town in the Northern Cape, and we were talking to the community there, and one of the questions I was asking is about the health clinics and the community structures there, the health, the clinic committees. And I was told that those don't function because they are captured by the politicians. So even the things that our policies have made available for communities to have a voice have been captured. Universal health coverage, particularly resource allocation, respectful and impactful partnerships, because we can't do this by ourselves, and like others who have really appreciated the relationship that we have with the province and others that help us with the academic project, I think it's an important thing to acknowledge the partnerships. And research, and really just to think outside the box and collaborate with people we wouldn't ordinarily collaborate on. I think what I've tried to show is that the things we have won are really fragile. And if we really don't deal with the social and the structural determinants, we will really have much to lose. As I end, I want to highlight this very important editorial that the current head of department wrote about. And some might like to believe that racism is pre-94, is gone, but he showed in this editorial, and in others also have shown in many writings, that no, racism is right here, it's alive and well. He shared a paper of our own registrars that experience racism. And it's not just about the experience, even though that is absolutely important. It's also about the fact that even if you look at from a research front, Blacks are underrepresented in trials, which means we can't really give them the absolute best evidence-based care. Ndobeko said one of the defining public health challenges of our time is racism. And he said, I believe that the responsibility for fixing these disparities lies with all of us in acknowledging our role as part of a system that enables the perpetration of inequality. We have a huge mountain to climb if we are going to have the voice in the globe, in the globe. Because as you can see, I don't even think you can see it. We just barely make a blip over there in terms of the papers that have been first authored or co-authored by people from sub-Saharan Africa. So have we significantly changed the lives of people to prevent disease and improve their opportunities for health and well-being? I'm not so sure. Particularly because our gains are so fragile. And I think largely because we haven't really addressed social and structural determinants of health in a significant and sustainable way. Ndobeko referred to this quote, which is in your paper with Prof. Mayosi, to say we still really have some way to go in terms of addressing these issues. I really want to highlight something that we don't often highlight when we talk about social determinants of health, are those structural determinants, and in particular around anti-racism and decoloniality. You saw this and spoke about this. You said attitudes of either superiority, inferiority, it often incited South Africans to either dominance or subservience. It often evoked either overconfidence or suspicion, and frequently led to either arrogance or escapism. South Africans must all be re-socialized in the fundamentals of basic human rights and relations. They must be rehumanized in self-assertion and self-control. Respect and caring for one another must be cultivated anew. This implies not only a political will and a commitment to change, but also an even more and a more personal will and willingness to change and be changed. I think you recognize that even though there is institutional racism, there is interpersonal racism, and there is also internalized racism. And you recognize this, and you understood that anti-racism is rooted in action, and that all of us really need to act if that is to change. I thank you.
Thanks so much, Tracy, for that really formidable and wide-ranging talk that it sort of captures where we are today in terms of the intractable problems we have, some of the progress that we made, but the challenges that remain for us as healthcare workers and as you know, a Faculty of Health Sciences in South Africa. So thanks very much. Tracy, do you have time for one or two questions?
Yeah.
Any questions from the floor? I'm going to ask a question then. So Tracy, I mean, just to get back to the burden of disease, you've highlighted the issues around COVID and HIV. Obviously, one of the big spectres in our health in South Africa in the years to come is going to be non-communicable diseases, as they have far more impact on poor communities, diabetes, the complications of obesity and cardiovascular disease. How do you see that playing out? And is there anything that we can do to prevent the impact that that's going to have in our communities?
So one of my mentors is the late David Saunders, and he has written extensively about this. And it's very much also about addressing social and structural determinants. Part of the things that we do, particularly as health practitioners, we throw drugs at the problem. I think that, yes, there is a place for medical interventions, absolutely, but I don't think we do enough around prevention, which you've also highlighted in your paper when we're talking about the burden of non-communicable diseases around the white population at Côte d'Ivoire. I think that is still the challenge. We don't do enough in terms of health education, et cetera, but we don't do enough in terms of making accessible healthy foods, healthy opportunities for physical activity, et cetera. I mean, many communities live in quite violent areas. So even physical activity, taking a walk in your community, is not as easy as some people might think. So I think that what we really need to do, more than I think the medical interventions and the drugs and all the rest of it, is really go back to basics and focus on prevention, early detection, and early treatment and adherence. And all of that is largely on the primary healthcare platform. And I think once we can do that, you know, all the specialists here, I think, will actually be able to do more with less.
Janet, you have to speak into the microphone, because otherwise the online audience won't hear.
Thank you very much. Tracy, thank you very much for that very extensive, wide-ranging talk. I'm reminded, as a medical student, I learned that Victorian Britain's public health was based on clean water and sanitation. And we are failing dismally in this country. So, to put a big weight on those fairly narrow shoulders, what can we do as UCT to influence those who are responsible for clean water and sanitation in our country?
Well, I think, you know, I think professors are very, very influential. And I think we in the academy have a voice, and we need to speak and we need to write and we need to talk about it. but we must also be willing to sacrifice. Part of the challenge is that, yes, let's do that, but the minute we say, you need to give up, that's when we say, not on my studio. And I think that's a challenge. We are part of the problem because we talk about all of these things, we say all of these things, but when it's time to cut up the cake in such a way that we can actually share, we don't want to. And I will highlight, you know, that was in my time under Housem when we were implementing Healthcare 2010, that actually the professors at Groteskier were the ones that did not want resources to go to the primary healthcare platform. And as the provincial government at the time, and I was part of that, we got a lot of flack from politicians about why are we kind of killing academia, et cetera. So yes, we need to have a balanced health system. I'm not saying that the tertiary services are not important, but I'm just saying that we also have to recognize that whatever it is that we say, there are implications. There's a fixed resource and we have to share and we have to think where is the biggest bang for buck and how do we do that?
Thanks again, Tracy. Yeah, I know you've been giving a lot of thought to NHI specifically and perhaps helping us move forward, and I just wanted to hear some of your thoughts around that. Thanks.
Well, for me, you know, the pooling of public and private resources is a no-brainer. I mean, I think I've shown you that actually we really haven't moved much in terms of that, you know. I think there have been some concerns about the how and some of the issues. I know that there have been a lot of conversation and but you know, very little has been written because everything has been overtaken by COVID, but there was huge momentum around that. I personally believe in the NHI, and we have, I mean, even as UCT, even as a deanery, have been engaging on trying to make sure that the policy instrument actually delivers on what it is the mandate. Yes, there's a lot that you can criticize, but I think my own view is that how do we make it work? Because absolutely, putting resources together and really having one health system that we can all access, regardless of who we are and how much we have, for me, is an absolute imperative. So I really am keen to also hear what the new version looks like, because I am aware that there has been a lot of conversation and a lot of people have been giving input. So I'm not quite sure what the final iteration will look like. Thank you very much.
Thanks once again, Tracy, for that great talk. So we now move on to bioethics. Our speaker is Professor Anton van Ecke. Anton is Professor of Philosophy and the Director of the Center for Applied Ethics at Stellenbosch University. He created the center in 1990, and since 1996, he and his colleagues have been offering a postgraduate diploma and an MPhil degree in bioethics. Anton was one of the first appointments as a distinguished professor at Stellenbosch. He was awarded both the Chancellor's Medal for the Best Student on Campus in 1980, and the Chancellor's Award for the Distinguished Career at Stellenbosch in 2016. He's published extensively, 21 books, more than 100 articles, more than 60 book chapters, and more than 300 popular articles and columns, and has worked closely with Solly over a period of 30 years. And he will be speaking on the issue of the development of bioethics in South Africa.
Thank you very much, Graham. Ladies and gentlemen, and particularly Professor and Mrs. Benatar. As always, it has been a great privilege for me to again cross the Lisbeek and join up here. I think of the numerous seminars we've had on Friday mornings in the tea room there. I think it was on J floor, and how that has sharpened my own and many other people's skills in the process. You were really a wonderful mentor to all of us. I was asked to say, ladies and gentlemen, something about the development of bioethics in South Africa. While I don't think of myself as an expert in this field, my task is considerably simplified by the fact that I am requested to talk on this topic at the celebration of my dear friend Solly Benatar's 80th birthday. I say simplified because the development of bioethics in South Africa is essentially, as far as I'm concerned, the story of Solly's central role in molding and thus developing bioethics at both an intellectual and a practical level to become the discipline and the activity that it nowadays is in the story of bioethics in South Africa. So the story of bioethics in South Africa is, as far as I'm concerned, essentially the story of Solly Benatar. Let me therefore start off by thanking the organizers of this event for the great honor of bestowed on me by your invitation. My talk will be structured by two general themes. The first is a quite broad overview of the discipline of bioethics in South Africa, followed in the second place by a few direct pointers at Solly's distinctive role in the development of that narrative. What do we understand by the term bioethics? I understand two things in this regard. Firstly, bioethics is, I think, the outcome of systematic reflection on moral problems that arise in healthcare and the life sciences generally. Secondly, bioethics refers to institutional practices that provoke or are influenced by such reflection. For instance, the institutionalized generation of an abortion law in Parliament would be an instance of bioethics activity. The advent of bioethics in its clinical guise in this country, as in many others, closely entwined with and deeply influenced by our colonial history, which goes back to 1652, if not in fact so significantly even earlier. Up to the advent of the 20th century, there was very little clinical ethics, simply because there was so little that healthcare practitioners could de facto do for really sick people. And what they did was often mortally dangerous, as we know. During the first 60 years of the previous century, bioethics in South Africa, and here I quote an article by Solly and Willem Landman, bioethics in South Africa largely took place within the framework of the authoritarian, beneficent, paternalistic behavior of professionals supposedly adhering to the Hippocratic and related codes, end of quote. Wherever bio or clinical ethics occurred during these years, it was, and I quote again, limited to the discussion of ethics codes, professional secrecy, advertising, the conduct of consultation fees, financial matters, and upholding the traditions of medicine, with only brief reference to abortion and sterilization and to the ethics of investigative medicine, end of quote. The first book on bioethics in South Africa with the title of Medical Ethics was written by Professor Guy Elliott in 1954. It does refer to ethics, to the discussions on ethics in the ranks of MASA and the SAMDC. Slowly, other authors such as G.C. Oosthuizen followed the latter with a book on organ transplantation, particularly in the immediate aftermath of Barnard's achievement in 1967. The rise of the new bioethics in the 20th century was by and large the result of events in the course of the Second World War. This was precipitated by the atrocities committed by Joseph Mengele and other so-called Nazi doctors in the death camps, and provoked a wave of moral indignation all over the world, as rightly it ought to have. For the first time, it was now clear that healthcare professionals are not necessarily moral angels who only seek the best for their patients. They could become, and in these events, in fact, did become, moral monsters. What level of moral outrage was generated in South African circles as a result of these revelations is difficult to ascertain. Two other events sparked new and startling public responses in the course of the 1960s in South Africa and elsewhere. The first in 1960 was the so-called Scribner shunt, that is the first instance of renal dialysis performed by Dr. Scribner on his patient Clyde Shields. And the second was, and I've already referred to that, the first successful heart transplant committed by Professor Christian Barnard in the building right next to where we are at the moment. Speaking of that, I wonder how many of us are aware that Solly was around about that time appointed, we heard it today, 1980 in fact, appointed as HOD of Medicine at UCT and at Grote Schuur, and that he had the responsibility to facilitate Barnard's retirement when the latter's severe arthritis made it impossible for him to continue operating. Solly's story about that event, which he personally had told me, is quite intriguing. However, the most provocative event in South Africa that in South Africa awoke clinical ethics reflection from its apparent slumber up to the end of the 1970s was, of course, the death of Steve Biko. As we all are aware, Solly played a pivotal role in formulating positions and developing critique against the perpetrators of this heinous event. There is unfortunately no time to discuss the Biko affair and Solly's role in its adequately. In this respect, I will settle for just a few remarks. Amidst the outrageously bad and unprofessional treatment that Biko had to endure and the unfathomable tragedy of his premature death, it was encouraging at the time to observe to what lengths a few high-profile medical academics, of which Solly was one, went in order to force the organized medical profession to admit serious ethical misdemeanor in their midst. Their actions in the end led to the dismantling of existing medical structures for professional licensing and oversight, and to have these replaced by new organizations. In this respect, I quote the following passage that Solly and I wrote with reference to the Biko event. Quote, "It is no exaggeration to claim that the Biko affair, together with other factors, played an important role in sensitizing the country at large about the dire need of a culture of human rights in South Africa. The Bill of Rights that today introduces the South African Constitution, which was finalized in 1996, as we know, is therefore in a special way a testimony to the important lessons learned in South Africa from the Biko affair and from the canons of medical ethics. In this sense, it can be argued that the Biko affair was also a very significant turning point in South African history and an illustration of the social and political impact that a severe violation of medical morals had on South African society." End of quote. Space and time only allow me to flag a few other central events or themes that were predominant in the developing of bioethics and to indicate the roles that Solly played in addressing these issues. First of all, we saw since the 1980s the increasing inclusion of bioethics in the curricula of several philosophy departments and medical faculties in South Africa. This has been largely in synchrony with the Western tradition of medicine and the associated advances being made in bioethics thinking and education in the Western world. Solly played a central role in creating and developing these curricula. Something about bioethics and AIDS. One of the main health crises that Solly took an active lead in order to utilize, bioethics to its full potential was the HIV pandemic. This pandemic posed and continues to pose a major challenge to population health in the new South Africa. The intense suffering, loss of human labor power, and the increased work required for AIDS sufferers increasingly and profoundly affected the lives and well-being of all in South Africa. How to deal with this crisis raised many complex ethical concerns. The crisis was, of course, exacerbated by the denialism of the then president and his health minister in the 1990s. I well remember a number of public statements in which Solly's voice was clear, leading the protest against these developments. However, Solly, in his dealings with the ethical challenges posed by HIV, throughout insisted that we ought to avoid simplistic strategies in dealing with that pandemic. Clearly, scientific progress and the delivery of modern medical care make major contributions to dealing with disease, as illustrated by the development of effective antiretroviral drugs for the treatment of AIDS, their impact in wealthy countries, and the success achieved in lower income countries such as South Africa. However, the role of extreme poverty, subhuman living conditions, lack of access to basic education, poor sanitary and living conditions, dysfunctional families, lack of recreational facilities, sexual freedom, and the high crime rates should not be underestimated in understanding the phenomenon of HIV in South Africa. All of these that I've mentioned are endemic to Africa and are fueled by the powerful forces that have been promoting global disparities for many generations. Solly was in the process adamant that some blame can also be laid at the doorstep of major international institutions driven by the imperialist economic and ideological power of wealthy nations. Recognition of the adverse effects of overt racial apartheid in South Africa, while failing to recognize the adverse effects of COVID economic apartheid in at a global level, regrettably reflects a form of what Solly likes to call selective moral blindness. He often pointed out that it is becoming an increasingly important social function of bioethics in South Africa to unmask these forces and to insist on a broad contextualizing of bioethical discourse. As he argues elsewhere, bioethics should become operational not only at the micro level of interpersonal clinical relationships between patients and healthcare workers, but also at the meso level of institutions, as well as on the macro level of relationships between states and the operations of multinational corporations, etc. Then something about the establishment, training, and effects of research ethics committees for medical research, which in the latter part of Solly's bioethics career played a very important role in his life. As in the rest of the world, clinical research has become a major enterprise and an instance of big business in South Africa and increasingly in other parts of Africa. In that chapter on health research in South Africa in the late 1919 edition of the South African Health Review, Mbewe and Ngonmezulu write that for many years prior to democracy, South Africa had been regarded as a so-called researcher's paradise, because of its first world technology alongside a third world captive population, largely unprotected by codes of conduct and with extremely poor human rights protection. Consequently, health research done in South Africa and other African countries was often not submitted to rigorous ethical scrutiny in a manner that would have been required in the developed countries, and the benefits, if any, of that research were often not made available to the populations among whom the research was originally done. A lot of what is currently done in bioethics in South Africa deals with capacity building in research ethics, and particularly capacity to participate in the ethical review of research protocols. It is also in this respect that Solly played a major leadership role, setting up and chairing a number of research ethics committees, assisting with formulating international documents related to bioethics like the Helsinki Declaration and many other responsibilities. A high point in his career in this respect was his appointment by the South African Minister of Health as the first chairperson of the National Health Research Ethics Council, the highest policy-making body for ethics in the country. In this respect, Solly got the wheels properly rolling for a body that was created by the most recent Health Act. Growing interest in research in developing countries since the HIV/AIDS pandemic thus reflects renewed and encouraging interest in and concern about the nature of the relationship between researchers and their subjects. Appreciation of concerns regarding research in developing countries requires some knowledge of the growing global disparities in wealth and health, and of the lifestyle and worldview of potential research subjects. To quote Solly in this regard again, against such a background, it is apparent that the ethical dilemmas faced in conducting collaborative international research can only be addressed satisfactorily if research ethics is seen as being intimately linked to healthcare, to human health globally, and to the promotion of social and economic progress that could begin reversing widening global disparities in health, an idea propagated by Africans. End of quote. It is time to conclude. I trust that my paper gave some indication of the way in which the development of bioethics in South Africa is, to a significant extent, the story of Solly Benatar and his unrelenting efforts to build the discipline and practices of bioethics in South Africa. Time does not allow me to refer properly to other singular achievements of Professor Benatar, such as his presidency of the International Association of Bioethics, the grants that he solicited from the NIH for setting up an excellent postgraduate diploma in bioethics, and not least of all, the regular, and I've already referred to them, the regular Friday seminars that ran for many years and enabled many of us to sharpen our intellectual and moral skills in discussing fascinating ethical cases. An academic like Solly Benatar hardly crosses one's path more than once in life. I am extremely thankful for the privilege that I had of working closely with him for many years, and to see collegiality grow into some significant personal friendship. We are all very thankful that his health, which has at times been frail, is holding up well at the moment, and we wish him and Evelyn the very best for the future. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Professor Van Niekerk, for that really wide-ranging historical overview and weaving in Solly's contribution to the field in South Africa. Can I ask one question?
Yeah.
Just if you could reflect on the impacts that the bioethics in South Africa has had internationally. The impacts of the work that's been done in South Africa has had on the field internationally.
Well, I think Solly is in a much better position to express himself on that. I don't think it has had, apart from his personal role, which I think is a very, very significant one, particularly in terms of his election as chairperson of the IAB, the International Association of Bioethics. The number of people involved in bioethics and that operate at an international level, they have certainly multiplied. To speculate on their actual effect, in terms of changing things around, That would be very difficult for me to express myself on. Maybe Solly has some ideas about that. But I certainly hope that that it continues to grow.
Thanks very much. So to move on to our next speaker, we're joined online by Professor Ross Upshur, who is the head of the Division of Clinical Public Health at the Dalai Lama School of Public Health and Associate Director of the Lunenfeld-Tannenbaum Research Institute Sinai Health. At the University of Toronto, he is a professor at the Department of Family and Community Medicine and the Dalai Lama School of Public Health, adjunct scientist at the Institute of Clinical Evaluative Sciences, and an affiliate of the Institute of the History and Philosophy of Science and Technology, and a member of the Center for the Environment. He's a staff physician at the Hennick Bridgepoint Hospital, Sinai Health. As many of you know, Solly has been invited to lecture every year since 2000 at the University of Toronto Medical School. And through this connection, Professor Upshur and Professor Benatar have collaborated on research and teaching for over 20 years at the University of Toronto and at UCT. And Professor Upshur is going to address us on the topic International Research Ethics, Public Health Ethics, Global Health Ethics, and Medical Professionalism. So I hope, Ross, that you, I can see that you're online and that you'll be able to upload your talk. You're on mute.
Mic is on mute.
I think you're still on mute, Ross.
I think we just lost him.
Okay, perhaps then we could move on to the next speaker and then come back to Ross, if we've lost Ross. Because we have a recording for the next speaker. So I'll go, should I move, Denzel, move on to the next speaker?
Yes, we can do that.
Okay. So the next speaker is Professor Stephen Gill, who is Distinguished Research Professor of Political Science, Communications and Culture at York University. He is a Fellow of the Royal Society of Canada and a Senior Associate Member of St. Anthony's College, Oxford University. His teaching is in the fields of international relations, global political economy and social and political theory. Professor Gill became the 2021 Kellam Laureate in Social Sciences in recognition of, and I quote, his scholarly excellence and impactful research on global affairs and international relations. Much of his recent work has involved fruitful collaborations with Solly Benatar, focused on ethical, social, material and ecological aspects of global and planetary health. And Stephen's talk is entitled The Political Economy of Global and Planetary Health. And Stephen recorded his talk, and that's going to be played now.
Everybody, my name is Stephen Gill from York University in Toronto, and I'm honored to present at this symposium on behalf of Solly Benatar, with whom I have been friends and a collaborator in joint work for over 20 years. And I also want to thank the organizers, Professor Natusi, Professor Manches, and Sahana Rangel for organizing this and for taking care of all the technical aspects. my talk will be with the following title. And you'll see that I'm focusing on global and planetary health and also trying to look beyond the COVID emergency. So these words are in honor of Solly for his inspiration and from everything I've learned from him. So let me try to summarize what the talk will be about. Perhaps the best way to start would be to just give my general perspective on the question of global and planetary health. It's inspired by one of my favorite political thinkers, Antonio Gramsci, who used the following maxim as a maxim of political analysis, namely pessimism of the intelligence and optimism of the will. I think we have to look at the world with all its violence, its power structures, its inequalities, its injustices as it is, but we have to try and look beyond it and look towards a future which could be changed and reshaped through constructive and progressive collective political action. So that's the maxim. And I'm going to start with two books. The first is a book that I did with my wife and co-author and colleague at York University, Professor Isabella Backer. And this was an attempt to create an approach to political economy that went past the obvious and normal ways in which it's understood as being the relationship between states and markets. We felt that that approach didn't go far enough to explain power structures, how production actually takes place, and how that's connected to what we call social reproduction. The many tasks that are involved in nurturing the young, in developing communities, caring for the old, as well as education systems and various other things that make it possible for the political economy, as it's conventionally understood, with its states, its markets, its systems of production and consumption, to actually exist. And that's really a feminist perspective to give a deep insight into the nature of the global political economy, its links to ecology, and how that relates to human security, how people perceive the nature of their circumstances and their possibilities for the future in a way that could be fruitful and free of violence and subordination. So in that book, we actually had a primary hypothesis, which was that there is basically a contradiction, a growing contradiction between the intensified power of capital and its pursuit of profits versus life-making and life-sustaining institutions, including the processes associated with the above and the condition of human bodies, their health, their minds, and also the condition of the biosphere. So it's a very ambitious approach, but it's meant to be comprehensive and integral and introduces this concept of social reproduction into the nature of political economy. And we followed that up with a subsequent volume in 2019 to elaborate on that more comprehensive definition, because we believe it enables us to get closer to some of the key issues of health and sustainability in the future. So I'll now move on to the second volume. It's really a category of, a category of work that I've done with Solly Benatar, which is attempts to take this forward, going beyond narrowly biomedical models of health. The idea being that many of the determinants of health are social and political, as well as environmental and ecological. So global health is really about the well-being of populations and their health, whereas planetary health goes beyond that and encompasses people and other living beings and ecosystems in the biosphere, because we need the air we breathe, we need nature, and so on. And the contradiction, which I pointed out earlier, can be focused on that set of questions. Now, our central starting point is fairly simple, that the good health of populations is rooted in the social and political conditions that allow people to flourish and develop their potentials. And those foundations that underpin that potential include nutritious food, water, and so on, and the list of these things which is here on your screen. And these will be obvious to most people, but they're often ignored in discussions of health. So let's go a bit further into this planetary health perspective. We published a long article in 2020 and made these arguments that the health of the planet and its people is really fundamentally shaped by global capitalism and geopolitics. And global capitalism and geopolitics are clashing right now in Ukraine, but there are many instances of this interaction. Within that context, disparities or inequalities in health are shaped by social forces, and most of these are connected to subordinations and stratifications associated with race, class, caste, and gender. Now, within that context, if we think about the way in which actually existing capitalism works, its dominant model is what I call market civilization. It's a worldwide development model that's based upon the primacy of market forces and market values, globally interconnected on a 24/7 basis across the globe. It is profit oriented. It's very ecologically myopic. It's very energy intensive. It's based upon individualism. It's very consumerist. And as we can see, it's been increasingly crisis ridden over the past few decades. Its dynamics are unequal. It rewards basically about 20 to 25% of the world population, mainly in affluent countries, but throughout the world. And it marginalizes the possibility of a healthy life for most of the world's population. So those are the arguments that we made. Now, we'll go to the next slide, because that indicates that our current situation is driven by morbid symptoms. And they're not simply morbid symptoms concerning human bodies. They are concerned with pollution, species extinction, various monocultures of production and the mind. For example, cattle and chicken production has basically marginalized other forms of nutrition in many parts of the world. And also the various other things that we could get into in any discussion. But basically, these morbid symptoms are imbricated in global power structures and contemporary capitalism and the cultures that it generates and the way in which it tends to commodify health. Now, what's important, I think, in this situation is to underline that law is very, very significant. Law and politics are very significant in this configuration, because it's often overlooked that capitalism it rests upon power of the state and its role in enforcing private property rights. And in particular in health, intellectual property rights, which are basically monopolies over products and technologies and treatments, are crucial because they confer legal rights on their owners, which are protected by states and international organizations. And indeed, corporations can use these rights to supply or deny access to medicine and treatments based upon the ability to pay. Very, very manifest in the current problem with COVID, but it's manifest across the board because of the power of large corporations in shaping health. So on to the next slide. We ask the question then, how can we think about how the COVID-19 pandemic and the associated economic crisis has impacted health? Now, I think the first thing I would say about this is to quote a maxim from the book of Matthew in the Bible. To him that hath shall be given, and to him that hath not shall be taken away. The general pattern has followed that maxim. And during the pandemic, already extreme inequality throughout the world has worsened and poverty and hunger have grown. We see the way in which vaccine apartheid has actually operated. We've seen how climate pollution in capitalism, including chemical pollution, still pose massive threats to health. We've also seen how the use of the economic power of governments through their bailouts and borrowing shows how money mainly flows from the richer, from the poorer to the wealthier nations and people. And so it poses the question which people are asking throughout the world, what to do about the future? What can be done? And I'll suggest towards the end of this talk, based on work that I've done with Solly, that this calls for a new paradigm of development and some ethical and political initiatives that are sorely needed to be taken. So, as I said, inequality has worsened, and both within countries and between countries, these inequalities have widened. Millions have been left unemployed, whereas numerous firms have seen massive profits. We could get into the details of that in discussion, but I'll just read something from Oxfam, who published a report earlier this year called Inequality Kills. They say the following: the world's 10 richest men made more than doubled their fortunes from $700 billion to $1.5 trillion, the rate of $15 per second, or $1.3 billion a day, during the first 2 years of a pandemic that has seen the incomes of 99% of humanity fall and over 160 million more people forced into poverty. I think that's a fairly dramatic encapsulation of these processes. And it recalls the words of the French existentialist philosopher when he was commenting on the plague in Algiers, that the plague shows and exaggerates the relationship between the rich and the poor. And I think that could be generalized on a world scale. So moving on, what does that mean? The pandemic is also a pandemic of hunger. And the numbers are quite striking in terms of this, and I'll just list them on the screen for you. You can read them for yourself. These relate to 2020 and 2021. By the scandalous situation in 2021, where 2.37 billion people, or 30% of the world's population, lacked access to adequate food. This is just amazing, amazingly depressing in that statistic. And moving on, you see here a snapshot of what I've called vaccine apartheid. I've not really coined that phrase myself, but it seems appropriate here. And it just shows, you can review this yourselves because we're going to provide a version of this at this PowerPoint for you to follow if you like. But you can see very clearly here that the highest income countries are the ones that have managed to vaccinate their populations almost completely in some cases, whereas the lower income countries are just really getting started. And the schemes to share vaccines throughout the world have not really succeeded very well as yet. And I have to say that my own country, Canada, behaves shamefully at the beginning of this process, because it took vaccines from that pool to use for its own population when it actually had plenty on hand to be able to deal with our local vaccination campaigns. So moving on to pollution, being pushed in the background a little bit, but I think a lot of people paid more attention to the pollution question when the lockdowns took place, because city centres and roads were empty and wild animals started to roam free in the cities. I remember seeing a documentary where people were 100 miles away from the Himalaya mountains and they could finally see the peaks of the mountains because pollution had dropped so much. So dramatic drop in pollution is related to the fact that we have approximately 7 million premature deaths caused by airborne pollution, very strongly correlated with COVID deaths, because people with respiratory issues are more vulnerable. And this number here shows you what happened, that during the lockdown, fossil fuel carbon emissions went down 5.4%, but they've gone up again since, as things have quote unquote got back to normal. And just the other day, the Independent Panel on Climate Change released its latest report, pointing out just how bad the situation is and how it tends to affect the most vulnerable locations and peoples the most. They're least able to cope with the effects of pollution and climate change. So the next issue is, where does the money go? Well, there have been enormous bailouts. It's very hard to be sure exactly how much money has been spent, but a conservative estimate would be in excess of $14 trillion, which is an enormous amount. The key thing about that is the way that it's been distributed and what the money has been spent on, and what the way it raises a certain basic question of political economy, which economists call opportunity costs. What are the costs what are the alternatives foregone by spending money in this particular way of deploying resources of this type? What else could you have done if you'd spent the money and used the resources differently? Well, the first thing to note is that the high-income countries were able to deploy huge amounts of their GDP compared to less prosperous countries. So they could really throw money at the problems, protect their industries, their banks, their businesses. In other words, to save the epicenter of the capitalist system, which is in the richer countries. Excuse me. The important thing about this is that the wealthy countries are able to not only spend more, but they're also able to borrow far more, and they pay much less in interest rates than the poorer countries. So if we look at the next the next line, we'll see that it calls for certain kinds of responses. The first thing to be said is, how do we summarize this situation? Well, I call this a global organic crisis. It's organic because it involves bodies, it involves nature, it involves the nature of our political system, it involves our capitalist economic system, it involves ethics, it involves health, suffering, and how the substance of life is at issue in the way in which the world is operating. And it requires significant change because it's not sustainable. It's not sustainable politically, it's not sustainable economically. So we need to change. There are many suggestions for change, but progressive groups throughout the world have mobilized on the basis of the UN Universal Declaration of Human Rights and the various UN covenants, which are based upon cooperation, solidarity, security and care for people and the planet, and an expanded comprehensive notion of human rights. Human rights are not just narrowly political rights, they're also material rights. And that is increasingly being grounded in an ecocentric perspective on life and health that acknowledges the need for a profound and socially just restructuring of global power, greater solidarity, and the development of sustainability. Those are the words of Solomon Benatar, and we put some of those words into some of our joint work. And he's absolutely correct that this is a new way to look at things. It's not a new way that we invented, it's a new way of looking at things that many people are now relating to. So let me finish by just pointing out some simple ethical and political initiatives. The first is that we need redistributive measures. And this is absolutely necessary. And you can see this in the COVID pandemic. If there had been an effective global campaign to vaccinate, many of the issues, the new waves, the way that they've overwhelmed countries that have been looking inward as opposed to outward, could have been redressed. But we need more than that. We need a reinvigorated fiscal basis on a global scale to help fund global public health, to better fund education, and to protect society, and to legally back and materially back universal rights, as I just mentioned, associated with those UN concepts. Obviously, we need policies to revitalize disease preparedness. We need greater coordination of public health resources at the national, regional, and global levels. Not easy to do. But finally, we need a more long-term perspective. We have to shift away from the destructive, myopic logic of energy-intensive market civilization with its ever-increasing consumerism. And again, to quote my dear colleague and friend, Solomon Benatar, we need to do better with less. So I think there is some grounds for optimism. Obviously, there are many grounds for pessimism, but we can't give up. We can't give up. I think we have to exercise some optimism of the will and build on the activities of millions of organic intellectuals throughout the world. Doctors, educators, trade unionists, peasant movements. There are millions of these people throughout the world whose voices have to be heard and whose collective action needs to make a difference. So thank you very much. Congratulations to Solly on his birthday. I hope he has many more, and I look forward to contributions from his other colleagues in this very august and important symposium. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Stephen, for joining us from Canada for this symposium and for that thought-provoking talk, really highlighting some of the fundamental factors driving disparity, poverty, and ill health in the world. There won't, unfortunately, be time for questions. We are running late. I'm going to move on to Ross, who can hopefully connect now.
Can people hear me now?
Yeah.
Oh, thank you. My sincere apologies. I've had a terrible computer day. I was originally planning to do this from the hospital, went to the hospital, it wouldn't allow me in, so came back home. It truly is an honor and privilege to participate in this symposium marking Professor Benatar's 80th birthday. But before I start, I'd like to acknowledge the land on which the University of Toronto operates, and that for thousands of years it has been the traditional land of the Huron-Wendat, the Seneca, and the Mississaugas of the Credit. And today, this meeting place is still home to many Indigenous people from across Turtle Island, and I am grateful to have the opportunity to work and, in fact, raise my family on this land. I've had the pleasure of collaborating with Solly for over 20 years, both here at the University of Toronto and at the University of Cape Town. And while we are justly celebrating his many accomplishments in the field of medicine and bioethics, and I was delighted to hear all of the reminiscence of Solly as a clinician. So as a practicing physician, the one thing Solly and I have never done is actually practice medicine together. So it was wonderful to hear about his many qualities and virtues as a mentor and teacher and clinician. And I think, you know, the tradition of qualitative research, we reached saturation within two or three speakers, all of who were unanimous in the characterizing Solly's excellences. But Solly's more than a collaborator to me. He truly is a true friend. And in the heat of the Nicomachean Ethics, Aristotle writes, "Friendship is as noble as well as necessary, and we praise those who love their friends and consider the possession of many friends a noble thing. And further, we believe of our friends that they are good." And I believe that Solly and Evie, and I'm very sorry I'm not there in person to be with you and with the boys, but I think that you epitomize the spirit of friendship. I know that it's obvious that you're in possession of many friends who are firmly on the belief on justifiable grounds that you are indeed excellent and good people. And so I want to just take a moment to thank both Solly and Evie for the many kindnesses and friendship that you've extended both to me and to my family. Now, Solly has collaborated with most of the major figures of this generation in the field of bioethics, and I think they would have all been better placed to give this talk than me. It's really hard to overestimate his influence and impact on the field. In fact, when I was thinking about this, I was reminded of the Monty Python skit about the summarizing Proust competition, where people are given a minute to summarize the entire corpus of Proust's writing. And in 20 minutes, I think even in the 3 hours that we've been together, we cannot do justice to all of the ways in which Solly has made an impact. But I thought the best homage came in an essay by Professor Rene Fox entitled "Moving Bioethics Towards Its Better Self, a Sociologist's Perspective." Now, those of you who know Professor Fox's writing, she was a keen, close, and critical observer of medicine and healthcare. And this essay was critical of the field of contemporary bioethics, particularly its myopic focus. And she argued that throughout its history, the field of bioethics has continued to be focused on a narrow area of medically associated phenomena, which has applied a limited set of ethical precepts that originate in Western and American philosophical thought. However, in a footnote, she observes, a notable exception is to be found in the thought, teaching, and publications of Solomon Benatar, Professor Emeritus of Medicine at the University of Cape Town, founding director of the Bioethics Center at that university, and adjunct professor in the Dalhousie School of Public Health at the University of Toronto. Benatar has written copiously and passionately about how imperative it is to address bioethically relevant events and questions, such as those associated with epidemic outbreaks of infectious diseases, among others, within a public health and global health ethics framework. Now, I'm not going to tempt fate today by trying to upload my slides, so I'm going to speak to the question that I wanted to talk about today. And I titled the talk, it was rather prosaically listed, but Ethics in the Time of COVID. And I think those of us who've been thinking about pandemics for some time, I'm going to just close that off, recognize that pandemics are quintessentially ethical events. They raise issues across many dimensions of ethical reflection. And there we go, it actually worked. And so we've already had some discussions. I want to start with the independent panel report for pandemic preparedness and response, which rather, I think, arrogantly came to some conclusions about what we've learned about COVID in May of 2021. And of course, here we are close to May of 2022, still within the grip. So we might want to figure out this pandemic before we start thinking about the next ones. But the report quotes that COVID-19 has been a terrible wake-up call and that we've been warned. And in an interview with the one of the co-chairs, Ellen Sirley, she said, one of the problems is, you know, that we've failed to learn from the past. So I want people to remember wake-up calls and learning from the past. I think the words of Albert Camus are particularly relevant here. He says that everybody knows that pestilences have a way of recurring in the world, yet we find it hard to believe the ones that crash down on our heads from the blue sky. He further observes that there have been as many plagues as wars in history, yet always plagues and war take people equally by surprise. And unfortunately, we are in the context of having both war and plague with us at this time. I could go back into the deep history, back to Thucydides' account of the plague of Athens, but I want to focus on the recent history. We'll start, for example, with SARS in 2003. SARS was meant to be, as you can see from these two headlines from the journals Time and Newsweek, major American news magazines, that we were supposed to learn how to live in the new age of epidemics. The questions asked there, why the virus spreads, what's the truth about SARS, was China covering up, how scared should we be? So these are all questions that we asked ourselves again during the SARS-CoV-2 pandemic. And in fact, the first time I was able to collaborate on a scholarly article with Professor Benatar was thinking and distilling the lessons that we've learned from SARS for ethics, and those resonate and still hold true today. But after SARS, we started to be concerned with avian influenza and the potential for influenza pandemics, particularly H5N1, highly pathogenic avian influenza. We didn't get that. Instead, we got the H1N1 pandemic in 2009. In 2014, we had a major outbreak of Ebola in West Africa. At that time, the head of the World Health Organization considered it the greatest challenge in the UN history, the greatest peacetime challenge. And of course, this seems rather quaint in light of what's happened in the past 2 years. There was this need to concern about threats to peace and security. And we've seen that reflected again with COVID-19. There was a dry run of a lockdown. In fact, Sierra Leone instituted the first true lockdown to try to capture all the cases of Ebola in the population. And now we've seen lockdowns around the world. The use of quarantine or restrictive measures to keep populations from circulating. Concerns about long-term impacts from the disease. And of course, we would be remiss in not thinking about MERS and Zika. And my one piece of advice is that when you start to see fumigators and spray cans coming out, we know that we're in the grip of something uncontrollable. After Ebola, there was a huge cry about the need to learn lessons. There was articles published in almost every major medical journal. But, you know, we've seen this language before. After SARS and after H1N1 in Canada, there were extensive lessons learned activities. And these are actually hard to find now because they've been archived. And of course, both SARS and swine flu were considered to be wake-up calls for global health. And it wasn't long before we started to see that same language. This is even in 2020, that COVID-19 is a global wake-up call, or that we need to learn our lessons. Now, a public health emergency of international concern is considered the loudest alarm that can be sounded by the WHO Director General. And as you can see on this chart, since the issue of an update of the international health regulations in 2005, there have been several public health emergencies of international concern declared. In fact, the alarm's been ringing for polio since 2014. And so if this is the loudest alarm and we're supposed to be waking up from having wake-up calls, I think something has gone deeply amiss. With a colleague, Max Smith, we published a sentiment that one of the most powerful lessons that we've learned from Ebola is that we don't like to learn lessons. We're being told that we have to wake up and learn lessons, and I sort of argued that we either have collective amnesia or collective narcolepsy. Now, one of the things I'm reflecting on the work that I've done and have done with Professor Benatar over the past 20 years is there seems to be a pandemic ethics playbook, that there are five sort of structural events that seem to occur with every epidemic that have their associated ethical issues. And Professor Benatar's work has actually addressed each and every one of these. We see that in many epidemics and pandemics that there's high early morbidity and mortality in healthcare providers and in their caregivers, raising issues around duty to care and duty to protect those who are at greatest risk. We may want to ask ourselves how well we've done during COVID-19. And still, yet again, we hear accounts that healthcare providers were not given adequate protection, adequate access to personal protective equipment. And you hear physicians and nurses quoted in the media saying they didn't sign up to this type of work to be exposed to this kind of risk, which asks us to reflect upon how well we're actually teaching our medical students and our nursing students on what it is that they're going to face. We also failed to protect the most vulnerable. Here in Canada in particular, there was a disproportionate rate of mortality and illness in long-term care facilities. So on the report card that we may want to ask issue after we've finished this, strikingly in that independent panel report, the word ethics and the word values do not appear. Secondly, high levels of uncertainty. We don't have enough evidence. So, for example, I was asked to co-chair the WHO Ethics and COVID Working Group for the WHO R&D Blueprint, which brought all of the scientific minds together to identify the priority research questions to ask to bring evidence to reduce that uncertainty, which of course means that we're going to be enrolling human subjects in research projects, which means that we need to take research ethics very seriously indeed, and fight back against pandemic exceptionalism, the claim that the normal standards of research ethics ought not to apply because of the urgent nature of responding to the pandemic. And once again, Professor Benatar has written persuasively on the need for robust research ethics, an early paper in social science and medicine, which really documented the disparities in the capacity of different systems to engage in capable and competent research ethics review, bringing different perspectives to bear. And at a meeting of the World Health Organization Collaborating Centers last week, I asked if any additional, so billions of dollars have been put forward into vaccine, basic research, clinical trials, how many REBs actually received additional resources in order to deal with the increased work that they would be facing? And the answer to that was that none of them had in fact received additional resources. The third thing is the need to, in the event of having no effective medical countermeasures, which was the case early in SARS, we need to rely upon public health interventions to control spread. That raises questions of public health ethics and how we justify the use of restrictions, masks, vaccines, quarantine and isolation, proximity tracing measures. And once again, Professor Benatar has written extensively on the importance of public health ethics and why we need to include this into medical training. And I'll speak to that in just a few slides. And of course, we face scarcity, and this raises issues around resource allocation and priority setting. And we've seen this in both high income and low income countries. How do we allocate vaccines when we have a short supply? How do we manage intensive care beds? How do we deal with personal protective equipment? And as you can see, each of these ethical issues is nested within each other. The first two really focused on individuals, the second moving up into public health ethics, and of course, moving into policy and meso and macro level issues around resource allocation. But what we've known, and it wasn't that SARS-CoV-2 exposed the great inequities that exist both locally within, say, a country such as Canada, where we have differential impacts, and globally, where there's huge between-country disparities. This has been known for some time, and Solly's work has actually fearlessly exposed these problems. And Professor Gill, who I was hoping to set up his remarks with my comments, spoke quite eloquently too as well. And these raise issues around public health and global health and get us to think about issues of solidarity, equity, and reciprocity. And these have all been evident during COVID, and one would hope that we were prepared. We had abundant guidance documents. In fact, the Nuffield Council on Bioethics just in January 28th, just a few days before a global pandemic was declared, before the Public Health Emergency of International Concern was declared, issued a magnificent report, strongly influenced by Solly's work, on research in global health emergencies. The WHO had produced guidance documents for managing ethical issues in infectious disease outbreaks. Yet when SARS-CoV-2 hit, it was like these issues were being faced for the first time. So we have to do a better job, and I believe we can. And just to sort of quickly, I know we're over time, I just want to highlight a few things that Solly has written in a very nice paper with a colleague, Dennis Donneman, talking about the disconnections between medical ethics and medical practice. And as I'm speaking at a medical school, they argue that they want to reinforce the longstanding central aspiration of the goal of fostering excellence in care of patients as a key component of both undergraduate and graduate medical education. However, they also need better education on disease prevention, public health, and greater emphasis on the social and societal determinants of health. And we've heard throughout many of the discussions how relevant and how profound these influences are in shaping the experience of illness and the likelihood of becoming ill in the patients that we serve. And in a paper that Solly and I wrote, where we tried to articulate the need to reinvigorate a connection with the virtues and values of medicine itself, this was stimulated by an article on health professions training in the 21st century published in The Lancet, in which they argued that it was important that physicians become sensitive to ethical issues, but they provided no language or tools other than empty language. But we argued that if we're trying to make transformative contributions to improve population health practice, we're going to have to be informed by a broader range of skills and concepts, which don't emerge easily from traditional bioethics with its focus on individuals. And that's why we need to include public health ethics, and global health ethics into the curriculum of both undergraduate and postgraduate training. So, COVID-19 has challenged all aspects of society. And in fact, we've seen a slight erosion of solidarity. Sadly, this morning on the CBC News, I heard that recent surveys indicated that Canadians were becoming less tolerant and less concerned with the well-being of others. After an original levée en masse, so to speak, at the beginning, a lot of care and concern and shouts of solidarity for healthcare providers, people have clearly become tired of this, and we need to find a way to build back concern for solidarity. Distorted views of freedom, a kind of neo-libertarianism that indicates that we have unfettered freedom and no responsibility, and certainly no responsibility for others. The COVID pandemic seems to indicate that we tolerate, and I would say encourage, inequity. And I think Professor Gill pointed that out when he talked about vaccine apartheid. But moreover, I think we've had a failure of moral imagination. And on my last slide, and of course, I would be remiss for not putting the champagne glass of world poverty, which Solly has used in many lectures that I've attended with him. But I want to conclude with Solly's plea for moral imagination, so that only moral imagination, our ability to imagine ourselves in the shoes of others, can enable us to alter our outlook and actions significantly. And quite at this argues that our moral imagination is dulled and insight into our global interdependence is diminished by insufficient public acknowledgement of how the quest of wealthy nations for endless economic growth and luxuries that their citizens expect has profoundly adverse effects on access to basic necessities for millions of others. So I'm going to close there. And thank you for this really profoundly gratifying opportunity to participate. Solly, happy birthday and love to you all there. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Professor Upshaw, for that really thought-provoking talk to end off on the symposium, really highlighting how COVID-19 has brought into sharp relief that the global inequities, the challenges that we face in global health, and in many cases exacerbated them. But that final slide really challenging us to think of ways in which we tackle these issues going forward and don't make the same mistakes in future pandemics. So Rob Dyer has his hand up. Is it a question, Rob? Yeah. Let me give you the microphone. We'll take one question.
Well, thank you both for fascinating lectures. In the context of pandemic exceptionalism, the term that you used, we've noticed in our research group that there's quite a lot of pre-publication press releases coming out during the pandemic, which are we right to be disturbed about these? That's the first question. And the second is, for example, one of these studies, we went and looked at clinicaltrials.gov, and we couldn't find the statistical plan. Now that, are we not right to be disturbed about that? Because the wrong interpretation can easily follow such press releases and shoddy control in clinicaltrials.gov, or am I naive?
No, you're. If I may speak to that, you were absolutely correct. It would be an entire separate presentation to talk about some of the shortcomings of the scientific process that have been exposed and exploited during SARS-CoV-2. In fact, I use it as an example to teach research integrity at the University of Toronto, because not only have there been proliferation of poorly conducted trials, null trials, but also blatant and outright fabrication, as witnessed by the Surgisphere papers that passed peer review at both the Lancet and the New England Journal of Medicine, that were entire fabrications. So we really need to take this seriously and put in place better processes for the next time, or even for the remainder of this time.
Stephen, any comment on that question?
No, but if I could make a general comment about the contributions that I've been hearing. Yeah, well, I think that the presentation that Tracy gave, for example, struck me as a microcosm of the world situation that we face and all its shortcomings, all its inequities and all its contradictions. And I would say that it requires intellectuals such as Sully, such as Ross, such as yourself, and many, many millions throughout the world to press for better policies of education, better public policies, and to try and link to the way in which power is mobilized. Because ultimately, many of the problems that we see are not just due to misjudgments. They're to do with the way in which our world is organized and an inability of the politicians to face up to the fact that we have to do things very differently. I think I've been impressed by the contributions, and just to echo everybody else, I feel very privileged to be part of this conversation. And I think it is a fitting tribute to Solly and to Evie, because they are a team, and to the Benatar family to have been central in the way in which many people have thought about these questions and in the way that they've inspired others. So I think it's a tremendous tribute to you, your colleagues, and particularly to the Benatars, that you've been leading figures on many of these questions.
Thank you very much, Stephen and Ross. I really appreciate your participation and input in the symposium. So I want to move on. We're almost at the end. If Sully wanted to make one or two remarks.
Thanks, Graham, and thank you all for staying. It's been a long afternoon, and I really would rather not say anything at all, but I can't avoid saying what I want to say because it really amounts to just a series of thank yous. I want to say thank you primarily to the Department of Medicine that I to see in my own mind as an enduring team since it first existed in the 1920s. The Department of Medicine has been, in my mind, an enduring team. I've known all my predecessors back to Professor Brock, Professor Foreman, and Professor Saunders. I didn't know Professor Falconer, but I've known all the people who've been associated with the Department of Medicine since Professor Brock's time. And also those after me, Ralph Kirsch, Bongani Mayosi, and now in Tobeko Ntuzi and Graham Bankies, in whom I have great confidence in carrying forward all the good things that the Department of Medicine has done over so many years. I also want to thank today's speakers for being willing to participate in the way they have and to pay me compliments, some of which I don't deserve and some of which I may. And all of those who've made time to be in attendance today in person and virtually, it's been a heavy session late in the day and I'm most appreciative of you all coming together. I also want to say thank you to the collaborators and colleagues who over many decades have offered and shared friendship and support with me in an enormously constructive manner. I feel greatly privileged to have had all those opportunities. The secretarial and admin staff in the Department of Medicine in my time were crucial. Without them, I could never have functioned. And I'm sure that the same applies today to all heads of departments and the staff that work quietly in the background. And I'd also like to pay tribute to the Kritzkia Hospital staff, many whom I've known personally over the years, people who perform quietly in the background and without whose dedication to work, we'd not be able to do what we've done. And our families who have been part of the team. And again, they all form the enduring team for the Department of Medicine in the past and into the future. I think the Department of Medicine has some shared values. We share some values which I want to just emphasize for a moment. The first is our dedication, our honest dedication to knowledge within our own disciplines and to professional care. The second is our dedication to high quality patient care with attention to the person, not just the illness and the dignity of each patient. We've all been devoted to advancing knowledge and to advancing skills in the care and the teaching of medicine, in the care of patients and the teaching of medicine. And we've tried, not adequately, but I think we have tried to pursue equitability in access to healthcare and concern for the vulnerable. And in particular, I think of some of the work we did about caring for prisoners and detainees at the time of our detention with our trial. I think at Critzia Hospital and in the Department of Medicine, we see ourselves as components of social capital. We're not just working for ourselves. We've taken a lot from society and we're trying to give as much as we can in return. We're part of the social capital, and that's why the public sector and the work that's done in the hospital and the Department of Medicine are so crucially important. And I think that what we've done over the years is we've sustained an exemplary role as a department within our medical school and within our hospital. We played a prominent role in desegregation in the 1970s and 1980s, in the extension of community activities in the 1990s and the 2000s, and in the 2020s, the example of the Department of Medicine and Critzia Hospital in providing care for COVID patients has been, in my view, exemplary. So finally, let me express my hope. My hope is that we will continue to strive for improvement, as we all have done in the past, in the spirit of cooperation and mutual respect for each other, which is absolutely crucial in a world that's become so competitive that we've forgotten about the collaboration and the cooperation that holds us all together. So thank you for coming. Thank you for putting on this session in my honor. I really feel humbled and most grateful for it. Thanks to all of you.
Sally, can I ask you to stay up here? Because there's one last aspect of this evening's proceedings that I'm going to ask Professor Mashiko Sechedi, who's the chair of gastroenterology within our department, if she will handle that part of the proceedings.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Prof, I echo what everybody has said. It has been such a treat to see you in person and to also see you looking so well. Thank you so much. There's no birthday celebration that is complete without a cake. I'm going to disappoint. I do not have a cake. Neither do I have balloons, but I have a small gift from the Department of Medicine to show our appreciation for all the work that you've done in the life of the department, past and current. So we have a plaque to present to you, Prof. And if it's okay with you, I'd like to read what it says. It says, awarded to Professor Solomon Benatar, the Department of Medicine of the University of Cape Town and Groote Hospital is proud to present this award to Professor Solomon Benatar on the occasion of your 80th birthday. We acknowledge with gratitude a career of service, scholarship, mentorship, and support within our department. Your contributions have had far-reaching impacts on the standing of our department globally, the performance of our health services, and the care offered to our patients. It's dated the 10th of March, 2022. So on behalf of the department, I hope you cherish this as much as we've cherished having you in our midst. Happy birthday and congratulations.
Thank you, Mashika. And thanks, Sally, for those words to close off this evening. Just from my side to say thank you to all the speakers once again for making this a fitting tribute to Solly's role within our department and within the global academic community. And just to say thank you to those involved in the organization, Sir Hannah Runglal, who did all the background work in organizing this, Zanella Magwa and Tolitemba Matalana, and then Marlon Phillips and Denzel Manel and ICTS colleagues. So that'll bring to an end the online event. If we can close the MS Teams, that'll bring to an end this evening. For the audience here in the venue, we have a light supper outside. I really want to encourage you, I know it's late, but just to join for 20 minutes, half an hour, share some reflections with Solly and with colleagues. And we have entertainment from the faculty orchestra, a small quartet led by Professor Steve Reed, together with three students. So please join us outside to reflect on this afternoon's symposium. Thank you once again.